Look at this day, 70 degrees in Tampa, Florida. Good day to be down on the field, and that's where we find Pam Oliver. Pam.
Thanks, Joe. And Eli Manning knows he's going to remain under a pretty hard spotlight until he gets that first playoff victory. But I tell you what, his teammates certainly have his back. Antonio Pierce told me he just loves the fight in Eli. OCU Manura says the defense works really hard to get him the ball back because they know he can do something with it. But Plexico Burris probably said it best. He says he reminds Eli of two things. First of all, don't second guess yourself. And secondly, just let it fly. Now for more on Tampa, let's go over to Chris Byers.
Pam, the Buccaneers' motto on defense all season long has been finished strong, and that came up last night. They broke out a tape from last year against the Giants and Brandon Jacobs when Rondé Barber got there first, but Jacobs wouldn't go down until five other Bucs swarmed to the ball. That's how they'll play it today. It's Jacobs first, Eli second on the priority list. And in pregame, word on some of the Buc players were talking about this being their first national telecast of the year. Already miffed about no Pro Bowl players. They want to show everybody what they're all about, as one player told me, especially those in New York. Joe, Troy.
All right, Chris and Pam, thank you. You saw John Gruden. There is Tom Coughlin. His season and the Giants' season turned around in week three in a comeback win over the Washington Redskins. Meanwhile, it's up to 72. Wind, not much. Humidity, 73%. Really, the only elements to deal with, Troy, is going to be heat.
That's right. And I had a chance to visit with Eli Manning on the field prior to the game, and no one was more excited about the weather conditions here in Tampa, Florida than what he was. But he admits that some of the weather was a factor in his performances in the second half of the year.
High short kick. And it's Hixon on the return for the Giants. Returned one against the Patriots last week. Breaks a couple of tackles after getting across the 30. They mark him at the 32. An 18-yard return. So here comes Eli Manning. And Troy, I would say this group is above average up in front of him, protecting him and opening room for the guy in the next group, Brandon Jacobs.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good group up front. They've done a good job all season long, a real unsung group, but they're doing it without their center, Sean O'Hara, today. They're going to have Gray Rugemer, who stepped in last week, but it should help that he's had the entire week to work with this unit.
Play action from Eli Manning, and he hits his big tight end, Kevin Boss. He's brought down immediately after a gain of four. And Boss is the guy who has taken the spot as the receiving tight end after the Giants lost Jeremy Shockey, a four-time Pro Bowler, to a broken leg in the Redskins game mid-December. This defense, as a group up front, they're good. They're younger at linebacker, as Nice makes the start in place of the injured Cato June. And they're good at safety with Tanard Jackson, the rookie, and Jermaine Phillips. Second and six. Toss to Jacobs, running left, trying to get to the edge, and he will not. Brought down by the middle linebacker, Barrett Rood.
You know, Barrett Rood has been one of those guys who has played well all season long, and he does a great job. He's here in the middle linebacker, and you can see the fast flow there, you know, across. This is going to be a defense that's going to be extremely difficult to get out on the edge. I know in talking with Brandon Jacobs, his favorite play is that off-tackle run, but he's most effective in the power running game when they're pulling offensive linemen and hitting the defense right between the guards.
Third and eight. Manning with a pocket comes underneath, incomplete, three and out. David Tyree, the intended receiver. Not a good start for the Giants. Three and out, and they're about to punt it to the Bucs.
You know, Steve Smith is a guy who's a rookie this season, was playing pretty good early in the season, and then he missed about 11 games. He came back. They feel like, you know, he gives them another weapon. Plexico Burris has pretty much had to be doing it for the most part on his own. Him and Amani Toomer. Amani coming off his knee surgery from last year. Steve Smith had an opportunity, but Eli just couldn't find him.
Fiegels hits a good punt, and a fair catch is received by Ike Hilliard. We'll stay here and set up the Tampa Bay Buccaneers attack. and it is engineered by number 7. Fifth different team in the last 5 years. The 3-time Pro Bowler Jeff Garcia, and a guy who just doesn't turn it over. Only 4 interceptions this year, 3 in the Jacksonville game, and only 6 since the start of last year. The key, though, Troy, is that first group, how a young, inexperienced offensive line handles the pass rush for the Giants.
No doubt, basically 2 rookies playing on the left side and then a couple young players on the right side as well.
Ernest Graham gets it, and Graham plows forward for 2. Graham is playing and starting and putting together a terrific season. This team lost Cadillac Williams in week 2. They made a trade, picked up Michael Bennett. Michael Pittman was injured, but Graham almost rushed for 1,000 yards in his 10 starts. Third and short coming up as Graham carries it. Aaron Ross on the tackle. A gain of 4.
You know, Ernest Graham, I mean, he's got a great story too. We had a chance to watch Todd Collins here over the last 4 weeks, and you know, when he got his opportunity and making the most of it. Well, you know, Ernest Graham, he's an undrafted free agent, came to the team in 2003, and you know, he's not the fastest, not the shiftiest, but he's just steady, and he's a guy who's always moving forward, and when given his opportunity this year, he has really played well for this team.
Third down and 4. Garcia steps up, throws, completes. Galloway, first down.
You know, Jeff Garcia came into this game not real sure what to expect of his own play because he's only played 6 quarters in the last 5 games, but you know, this is where he's really effective. You see the way he's able to slip and slide within the pocket. You know, this Giants defensive front does a great job, leads the league in sacks. But Jeff Garcia is going to be a hard guy to get down to the ground.
I want to ask you about that as we go along here in the first quarter. As you look at the numbers during the season for Garcia, they reverse it. Galloway, there's nothing there, and Galloway goes backward. Reggie Torber, the first one there for the Giants, a loss of 4. My question to you, Troy, is with a guy like Garcia, A, do you spy him, and B, how defensively do you rush him while at the same time trying to contain him and try and limit what he does within and outside the pocket?
You know, I don't think he's so dangerous, Joe, that you would put a spy, someone who just shadows him, in the pocket. But you know, you do have to keep him within the pocket. That's where he's most effective, is when he breaks contain.
Quick snap. Catch is made by Clayton, and he is forced out a yard shy of a first down.
And one of the ways you counter a defense that can put pressure on your quarterback is you throw the ball quick. And as we saw there, Jeff Garcia gets the ball. He pulls up and gets the ball into Michael Clayton's hands. And, you know, that's an effective way to try to slow them down, much like what you would do with a screen pass. If they're not going to cover up the receivers on the outside and put a defender over the top of them, you can expect to see a lot more of that.
Bucs have converted 1 third down, and now another is the fullback, B.J. Askew, who didn't carry the ball all season, gains 3. First down, Tampa Bay. Askew's going, wow, that's what it feels like to get a handoff.
Well, and B.J. Askew, I mean, he's really, he's a versatile player. He's an interesting guy. They consider him a true fullback, but the guy's 6'3". I mean, it's rare that you see a true fullback that is that tall, and he's also a pretty good runner, even though he doesn't get the ball all that often, but he's an excellent receiver out of the backfield. They've missed him the last 3 weeks.
Yeah, he had 18 catches during the season. Garcia bouncing, throws for Smith, incomplete. Trying to get it to his tight end, 6'4", 258-pound Alex Smith, and Fred Robbins was flushing Jeff Garcia right out of the pocket.
You know, you think back to last week, Joe, and how well this defense played for the New York Giants. As we see that last play with Garcia, Justin Tuck coming off the edge, and you know, you just know that Jeff Garcia is going to have to move. You can't sit stationary, and again, it's not something he really wants to do. This offensive line over the last couple of weeks has given up 8 sacks. Of course, Jeff Garcia not a big part of that. He's much tougher to get to the ground.
Second and 10. Whistles prior to the snap.
Delay of game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
And you go back and talk about, you know, this New York Giants defense and the performance that they had last week. I mean, they played exceptionally hard. They gave up a lot of yards to New England. New England got a lot of points against them, but you know, you could tell that they came out emotionally ready to play, and you just wonder as we move through this game, you know, are they going to be able to match the emotional level on both sides of the ball, not just defensively, but offensively as well. That's a tough task to come back after that kind of game and get ready for a game of this magnitude.
Second and 15, Garcia over the middle. That pass is tipped off the hand of Ernest Graham. I think, though, when it's all said and done, Troy, injuries or not, the Giants played that game against the Patriots the right way, and the net result is they're a much more confident team coming into the postseason this year than they were as a 500 club last year.
Yeah, and I think it went beyond the performance last week against New England, because if you think back to last year, I mean, they lost 6 of their last 8 games. This year, even though they stumbled a little bit, for the most part, they were able to win the games they were expected to win. The performance against New England only enhanced that coming into this game today.
2 for 2 on third down to the Bucs so far. Garcia with pressure down the sideline and the pass out of bounds. Good coverage on Galloway by Corey Webster, who gets the start today in place of the injured Sam Madison.
Yeah, Corey Webster is a guy they're going to want to go after, but Joey Galloway outside release, you can see there's just nowhere for Garcia to throw the football. I mean, with the position of Corey Webster, you have to lay it to the outside. Anything that gives him an opportunity to make that catch is going to be caught out of bounds. Joey's got to squeeze him a little bit more and give Garcia some real estate.
Webster started the first 3 games and was benched. And here he is back starting the postseason after the injury to Sam Madison. The quarters will stay away. And watch this one hop out of bounds inside the 15. They'll mark it at the 14-yard line, 42-yard punt. Giants have it, second time, no score in Tampa. Dealing with crowd noise are the Giants, who went 3 and out their first possession. Hand off is to Brandon Jacobs. Between the tackles, he picks up 3. Talked about the weather and how great it is here today, and then Troy added that Eli thought that the weather had something to do with his performance in the second half of the season. 46 at Chicago, 36 at Philly, that windy game against Washington at home when he was 18 of 52. Then the rain and windy day at Buffalo and New England. Decent day, 44, and the wind was not whipping around Giant Stadium. 2nd and 7. 4 wide receivers for New York. A blitz underneath it, Smith, and he's a yard shy of a first down.
You know, I think it's interesting, Joe, and you know, most quarterbacks, and I was one of those guys, you know, when you want to kind of get going offensively, especially in a big game, I always wanted to come out and hit a short pass, kind of get some confidence, and it didn't matter how easy the throw was. I mean, even if it was as easy as throwing a screen pass, I asked Kevin Gilbride, the offensive coordinator, is there anything you can do to kind of get Eli going pretty early in the ball game? And he said those things don't work for Eli. When you look back at his games where he's been most successful, they've started with big connections to Plexico Burris down the field. Think back to that game last week against New England. That's what happened.
Handoff and a loss. Brandon Jacobs swallowed up in the backfield, and Hovan was in the middle of it. Another 3 and out.
Well, Chris Hovan, he's going to be over the nose all day long. We talked about Sean O'Hara not playing, Gray Rugemer there, and Chris Snee, and he's just able to push the pile, and they just did not give up anything. Not enough movement along that offensive line. You get into those types of situations, 3rd and short. You know, those are the ones that you've just got to be able to convert.
Saw a picture of Sean O'Hara with his sprained left knee. Poor punt by Feagles, and Hilliard is hit and dropped immediately. Tank Daniels just added to this team. Downfield made the play. Hilliard made the catch and then went right down. Nothing on the return. Good starting field position for the Bucs. Their second possession, the ball at their own 46. Good defensive start for Tampa Bay. Garcia with a good pocket, airs it out downfield for Galloway. And overthrown. I thought it was impossible to overthrow Joey Gallo. I mean, didn't you? You couldn't do it. And Garcia had a tough time adjusting to the speed of number 84.
I never could. We were in Dallas just a short time. My last season, he had torn up his knee, had ACL surgery, out for the rest of the year. But I never could. I couldn't get the ball out far enough. I know when I asked Jeff Garcia that same question, he says, I don't throw that many balls up the sideline. And if he does, as he did on that last play, you've got to get it up awfully quick.
Sam Madison, who is out with the abdominal strain and inactive today. Handoff is to Ernest Graham. He's able to shake free and pick up the first down. Tuck couldn't bring him down, an 11-yard run.
Tell you what you're going to see is Ernest Graham here, and then he sees the cutback lane right through there. It's just a good job. I mean, this is typical of what Ernest Graham has been doing all season. And even with guys having an opportunity to bring him to the ground like Justin Tuck, he's just hard to get to the ground when you're only going down at his feet. I mean, he's just a tough guy. He doesn't have great speed, but he's a hard guy to get to the ground. And more importantly than that, he has great vision.
Quick throw left side. Clayton's been busy already. 11 yards and a first down. What Garcia tell you? Michael Clayton, when he gets the balls in his hands, when I get it to him, he runs angry. Well, and he had to be angry after getting a big hit there.
Yeah, I mean, he's just a physical receiver, probably as physical a receiver as there is in the National Football League. And the one pattern we're starting to see now is that Tampa Bay understands that Sam Madison's not on the field and they're targeting Corey Webster. Corey Webster right up here.
Handoff to Graham to the 25. Ernest Graham, an undrafted free agent, spent parts of 2 years on the practice squad and mainly was kept around because of his play on special teams because of injuries, notably to Cadillac Williams in week two. Here he is, and he has just burst onto the scene.
Yeah, he came into camp as their number three running back. I mean, he was Mr. August. The only time he really got his work was in preseason games. And you know, because of the injuries, as you said, Joe, they bring in Michael Bennett thinking that he's going to get more playing time, but Ernest Graham has just held on to the job and played well.
Gets it again. And he's brought down right at the marker. Depends on the spot as to whether it's third and inches or a first down. And we're going to have a measurement.
You know, the way they're doing it right now, Joe, is really their model. I mean, this is how they've had their success during the season. The thing that they do best offensively is not turn the ball over. And a big part of that is because of Jeff Garcia not throwing interceptions. But, you know, a lot of people think of John Gruden, West Coast. He was under Mike Holmgren, you know, so he's going to throw the ball around like so many of these guys like to do. But he is committed to running the football. I know some of those years that he was the head coach at Oakland, you know, they led the league in rushing. And so he's committed to running the football, taking the pressure off the quarterback, and then taking the shots down the field to guys like Joey Galloway. And when you've got a veteran quarterback like he has in Jeff Garcia, and as he had with Brad Johnson and Rich Gannon there in Oakland, you know, guys that are able to take the game plan from the classroom and execute on Sundays, you know, that's a nice luxury to have.
Third down and inches. Garcia keeps it and gets it. Going back to Philadelphia was not out of the question, at least as far as Jeff Garcia was concerned, after that run he had with the Eagles at the end of last year, beating the Giants in the playoffs. That didn't really happen, and there wasn't a whole lot of interest on the Eagles side, so Garcia went out on the open market. Tampa Bay had made a trade for Jake Plummer. He retired. They already had Chris Sims, but Garcia seems to be the right guy for this moment for the Tampa Bay Bucs. Graham over the right right side, and off the edge, the play is made. That was Strahan. A gain of only one.
You know, all Garcia does is give this team a chance to win, you know, each and every Sunday. And I think that when you ultimately evaluate a quarterback, that's what you've got to look at. And he did it last year. He was the MVP of the team for the Eagles last year. He's been the MVP of the team this year for Tampa Bay. And, you know, it's surprising that he's bounced around as much as he has, as much as a premium there is on quarterback play.
Jay Alford is injured. They look at him. We take a break. Not only does the injury, whatever it is, to Jay Alford affect the defensive line rotation for the Giants, but he is the kick center. The long snapper on the kick team, and it would affect that as well. Garcia looking left, now back over the middle, completes. Graham down to the six. Antonio Pierce, the middle linebacker, on the tackle, and a 14-yard throw, catch, and run.
Yeah, and this is where they're pretty good. I mean, Jeff Garcia is going to ISO the middle linebacker here with Ernest Graham. And so you see how much field there is to work there with Ernest Graham against Antonio Pierce. He had a two-way break, and you've got all that field to get open. I mean, that's a mismatch. Not that Antonio Pierce isn't a good cover guy, but when you give a guy that kind of room, I don't care who you are, you're going to have a hard time covering that back.
Hand off to Graham. Ernest Graham to the one. Second down and goal for John Gruden. Howie Long said it during our pregame show, and there are a lot of people who agree with regard to John Gruden. This may be his best season yet as a head coach in the NFL with all that he's dealt with. Yes, he won a Super Bowl after the 0-2 season, but he has molded this team, and they are obviously dangerous. Graham, touchdown.
Good execution there. You're going to see the pull here by the guard. He leads the way. That's Davin Joseph. They get in behind his block. They get movement. You see there, they're knocked into the end zone. Pretty easy touchdown there.
A drive that started at their own 46. And Graham has his eighth rushing touchdown in the last eight games. A Tampa Bay Buccaneer team that has not enjoyed the national spotlight all season long. The spotlight is on, and they lead the Giants late first quarter. A methodical march down the field for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. It featured a lot of Ernest Graham. 41 total yards on the drive, and a typical attack engineered by Jeff Garcia, who has mastered the West Coast offense and was really championed early in his career by the late Bill Walsh. Dominic Hixon from about the 6.5. He's a threat back there. Crossed the 25 by a couple of inches, where he met Rondé Barber. So now it's only 7 points, but Eli Manning and the Giants have to play from behind. Giants better be able to run the ball against this Tampa Bay defense. They're just simply not going to win this game. They've had the ball now for the third time at the moment. They've rushed for 1 yard. Brandon Jacobs tripped up in the backfield. Javon Hay.
Well, you look at what they're doing, Joe, defensively. Tampa Bay knows. They said coming in, we've got to stop Brandon Jacobs. And they've done that. They're bringing Jermaine Phillips. He's right on the line, the safety. They're making it known right before the snap that they're in an 8-man front. And then you've got to be able to win the one-on-one battles up front. And Javon Hay able to get through there. A guy who, one of those young players that we talked about, who's had an outstanding season to help this defensive unit.
Timeout Giants. And not a good start for this group. with Eli at quarterback so far, under a minute to play first quarter. And we showed you Monty Kiffin, father of the Tampa 2 defense, joined the Bucs as defensive coordinator in 96. The Bucs allowed the second fewest yards in the NFL this season. And for Kiffin, the 8th time he's had a top 5 ranking in his 12 seasons, the most in the NFL in that span. And during that time, the Bucs defense has produced 34 Pro Bowl selections, also the most in the NFL. He's a very quiet guy, very understated guy, a very smart guy. And whether it's Warren Sapp in years gone by or others that play for him now, Kevin Carter is here only because he was going to be coached by Monty Kiffin. He's one of the best ever.
Yeah, and Monty Kiffin, who does not have a contract for next season, which is beyond belief considering all the things that we just showed and the success that he has had as the architect of this Tampa defense.
Gaines Adams came across, and that's going to cost the Buccaneers 5.
Neutral zone infraction, number 90, defense. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
You know, you think of all the young players that have had to step up for this defensive unit, Gaines Adams being one of them, and Javon Hay, who made a play a little bit ago, and Kennard Jackson, a rookie safety who stepped in, and then even some of these veteran players, guys like Derek Brooks, was asked to take a reduced role, and they've taken 10 to 15 snaps away from him a game. And at first he was reluctant, but he feels that it's made him fresher, and he's had a better year this year as a result.
2nd and 9 after the 5-yard penalty. Manning with time guns it, incomplete for Steve Smith.
They try fitting that one in. Steve Smith, I mean, that was pretty good coverage down the field. They got him working over the middle on a square, and Eli having to avoid the rush on the outside. And a ball that was just a little bit behind him. Had he have been able to get out in front, maybe Steve Smith's able to make that catch. But pretty good coverage there by the rookie safety that I was just talking about, Kennard Jackson.
3rd down and 9. Pressure on Manning, and he is sacked. Gaines Adams, the rookie. This Buccaneer defense is flying around here in the first quarter.
Well, Gaines Adams, one of those young players who's been able to get pressure off the edge, and he's able to here. You know, he's working there against Kareem McKenzie, and there really wasn't anywhere for Eli Manning to step up in the middle. Derek Brooks was pressuring from the inside. It's one thing to have pressure off the edges, but when you're getting pressure up the middle, as a quarterback, you just don't have anywhere to go.
3 possessions, 3 3-and-outs for the Giants. And Hilliard, a former Giant, with a fair catch. They'll mark the ball at the 33. 15 seconds left in this quarter, and Eli Manning had nowhere to step up and throw.
Yeah, take another look right here at Gaines Adams and the job that he does. He's working against Kareem McKenzie, and because they bring Derek Brooks, that forces Brandon Jacobs to take him. And they're not able to give any help to Kareem McKenzie. And you know, you get a speed rusher like that, it's just, it's a mismatch. And so sometimes you try to put a tight end over on that position, but when a team's bringing blitzes, oftentimes you're going to find your blockers one-on-one, and that was the case on that last play.
It was Kevin Gilbride, the offensive coordinator, talking to Eli Manning. They've got to figure something out here fast, as the Buccaneers have it up 7. From their own 33, a blitz. And a loss on the play of 3 is Ernest Graham. Had to first get around Reggie Torbor. And it's a 3-yard loss. Good play there defensively for the Giants. End of the first quarter, 7-0 Buccaneers. They have the football. Not much to talk about for that defensive group for the Buccaneers. They played well so far. We're into the second quarter now, 2nd and 13. For the Buccaneers, up 7. Quick throw, and the pass is complete to Ike Hilliard. And Hilliard, who at one time was a 7th overall pick by the Giants in 97, the year they got Tiki Barber in the 2nd round, and a guy who was injured in his 2nd game with a neck injury, had to undergo neck stabilization surgery has become the leading receiver here with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers now in his 11th year.
And so many times, Joe, we all become infatuated with speed that we take for granted a guy like Ike Hilliard. I mean, he's a real pro. He's very dependable, runs good routes, he's tough. You know, he had a great career with the Giants, and he's played very well for this Tampa Bay team too.
Pressure on Garcia, buys some time and throws low for Joey Galloway. So it's fourth down, and that time the Giants defense stiffens up, and Garcia's hot as he comes back over to the sideline.
Yeah, and he's upset because he knows he had a chance there to get the completion and get the first down, and you know, doing a good job of avoiding the rush, but he just turned it a little low. You know, I mean, when he turned it loose, the ball was down low, and then Galloway not able to make that catch. But you know, had he have been able to make a better throw, they pick up the first down.
McWhorter's waiting for the Bidwell punt. Not a very good punt, and McWhorter's with a chance to return it. Good starting field position for the Giants. Down by 7. They'll start at their own 47. Jeff Garcia bought some time, threw low, and was ticked when he came to the bench. Good opportunity for the Giants, down by 7, starting at their own 47. Manning a setup and throw, and the pass complete to Plaxico Burress. His first catch of the day. Tomorrow it's the game college football fans have been waiting for, as Matt Flynn and the LSU Tigers take on Chris Wells and the Ohio State Buckeyes in the All-State BCS National Championship game. Our coverage begins tomorrow night, 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific, in high def, only on Fox. There's a former Buckeye. Joey Galloway now just watching, second down and 6. And a quick setup and throw. The pass is complete to Toomer. A couple of moves and down inside the 35 to the 32.
Well, if you look how Tampa Bay is playing defensively, I mean, they continually put the eighth guy up in the box. So they're challenging the passing game for New York. They're going to say, if we're going to win, if we're going to lose this game, it's going to be because of Eli Manning and these wide receivers. You see there, the drive on it there by Brian Kelly. I mean, it was close. Anytime you try to make a play on the ball like that, you're hoping you get help over the top from one of these safeties. And they were able to get it.
First down of the game. They go back to the ground, and Brandon Jacobs. And that big back pushes the pile for 3 yards. So for the New York Giants, the start to the game, 4 of their first 9 offensive plays went for negative yardage. And for New York, their -2 total yards in the first quarter. Fewest quarter in a postseason since 01. Second and 7. Manning throws to Toomer, and Amani Toomer is down inside the 20 to the 19-yard line. Another first down for the Giants.
Well, Eli Manning doing a good job that time of stepping up in the pocket. Greg White, who's an outstanding pass rusher right here off the edge, is able to get around Dave Deal and puts a good lick on Eli, but he hangs in there tough. I know he's been criticized for not doing that during the course of his career, but he sure did there and made a key throw to Amani Toomer over the middle.
First down at the 19. Jacobs gets it. Trying to string the play out. A gain of only 1. Ryan Neese out there to make the tackle for the Bucs.
Yeah, that goes back to what they tried doing there in the first quarter, and they've had success this season, you know, with that stretch play off tackle. But against this defense, because they're so fast, it's very difficult then to get onto the edge. I mean, when you think of Brandon Jacobs and the success that he's had this season, granted, he's missed 5 or 6 ball games this year, but the games that he has played, he's been extremely productive. So far, this has been his least productive day all season long.
Second and 9. Empty backfield behind Manning, and the pass broken up. Good play by Pearson, as Steve Smith was the intended receiver.
And Steve Smith, you know, some of just his youth shows up, because it was man-to-man across the board, and as a receiver working the middle of the field, running away from a defender, you know, that's a pretty good matchup, and he puts it right on him. You know, that's a ball that Steve Smith has to be able to catch. A guy, again, who has not played much because of injury, still kind of finding his way, but they're going to be relying on him, especially to work the middle.
Timeout is taken by the Bucs. Tampa Bay takes it when we come back. Third and long for New York, down 7. Want to amend something I said earlier about the Giants not being able to run it. If they don't run it, they're not going to be able to win. They will have a shot if Eli Manning can stand back there and pick apart this defense. Something that not a lot of quarterbacks have been able to do this season. But it seems like the Buccaneers are daring Eli Manning to beat them. Third down and 9. Over the middle, Amani Toomer, first and goal, Giants at the 5. Good throw from Manning.
Yeah, and Eli really handling the line of scrimmage very well. He's taking his time. He's able to see. They brought Rondé Barber off the edge, but he knew it was coming. And he also knew that they were going to be able to pick it up. And so because he was as patient as what he was, he made Tampa Bay declare immediately as to what they were going to do. And then Amani Toomer, I mean, this guy's been doing it for so long. Another nice reception for a first down.
Third catch of this first half for Toomer. First and goal. They leave it in Eli's hands. He gets it to Brandon Jacobs. Touchdown. Jacobs slamming the ball into that wall down behind the end zone, and the Giants pound it in. But that was a drive, Troy, where Eli Manning deserves a lot of the credit.
Yeah, and this was a good play by Kevin Gilbride. You're going to see it's a middle screen. Brandon Jacobs, he's going to come up. He's going to show protection, and then Derek Brooks read it. Derek Brooks, instead of going for Jacobs to make the tackle, he went for the ball to force an incompletion, and because of that, it gave Jacobs a clear path for the end zone.
Remember, the Giants are without Alford snapping for the kicker. Yet Tynes knocks it through. Alford are injured earlier. So the Giants answer. Finally move the football against the Buccaneer defense, and Brandon Jacobs let out some frustration. Good work by Manning. Tied at 7. Brandon Jacobs hasn't been able to run it, but he is on the receiving end of a 5-yard touchdown pass from Eli Manning, who was 5 of 6 for 49 yards. I talked about having to move it against this defense through the air. Manning is 0 for 2 in his postseason career, and this was the number one ranked pass defense in the NFL this season, the Tampa Bay Bucs. That was a good drive, and Michael Spurlock returns it for the Buccaneers and can't make the 25-yard line. So we welcome you back inside the booth, and well, we just saw a good drive put together by Eli Manning and the Giants, and it seems like something you said earlier, the defense for Tampa Bay saying, Eli, if you can beat us, it's going to be all on you.
Yeah, I mean, they're not hiding it either. I mean, they're coming up with the 8th guy in the box, Jermaine Phillips or Tanar Jackson, and they're putting him right there and saying, look, we're going to have an extra defender in the box. We're not going to allow you to run the football. They've not been able to run the football. And so with that, now play action, none of that stuff really matters anymore. Now it's about Eli Manning and these wide receivers being able to win within the passing game. They did that on the last possession.
Garcia over the middle, and the pass is broken up. Anthony Best, the intended receiver, and Antonio Pierce, the middle linebacker, was there defending for the Giants, 2nd and 10. Offensive leaders so far for Tampa Bay. 5 for 11 is Garcia. Graham with 30 yards and Clayton 2 catches. Giants fans making a lot of noise. And there are quite a few here as Garcia goes down. Ball may have come out. Michael Strahan with the sack. Ball stays with the Buccaneers. And this defense is starting to make plays for the Giants.
Yeah, they had some success earlier in the game, and you're going to see Michael Strahan working against Jeremy Trueblood. But eventually, when you're going up a guy with the abilities of a Michael Strahan, he's going to get the better of you. Not to say that Jeremy Trueblood isn't going to be able to hold his own at times, but right there, that was a mismatch. And so you try to balance that when you want to get five guys out, and then also recognizing sometimes we're going to have to give the young linemen some help.
That ball did come out. Garcia recovered the fumble. And now the pass is complete to Pittman. He is back to about a yard shy of the original line of scrimmage when Strahan brings him down. So a good series for Strahan. A gain of four, but a big fourth down coming up here, fourth and long.
And watch the screen here that they then try running off of Strahan. Here he had the big sack on the previous play, and they think, well, heck, let's just go at him with a screen play and get some big yards off of that. But you see, Strahan, I mean, he hasn't played in this league as long as he has without being able to recognize some of those things that teams like to do against him.
Bidwell hits a knuckleball, takes a Buccaneer bounce, and it's picked up by McQuarters, who gets to the 35. Michael Strahan has said he will tell the Giants by March whether he's coming back or not. He can still play. Had a very good year, 9 sacks during the regular season. He gets one here today. Giants have it, tied at 7. Giants will start at their own 35. Bradshaw in the backfield now for New York. And Ahmad carries it off the edge. A little more burst of speed than Brandon Jacobs. He picks up 8.
Go back and take a look at the touchdown that they ran there to Brandon Jacobs. There's Derek Brooks at linebacker. He sees it immediately, and then Brandon Jacobs, who's coming out of the backfield on the play action. There's Derek Brooks in the middle. And you can see he sees it immediately and jumps it. Just rather than trying to make the play on Jacobs, goes for the ball. And the Giants get the touchdown.
2nd and 2. A quick throw from Eli Manning gets it to Plexico Burris, who has a first down at the 46. Let's state again that this defense for the Buccaneers, number 1 in the league defending the pass, giving up an average of just over 170 yards per game. And so far, so good for Manning after they put it in his hands.
And I like what they went to there with Ahmad Bradshaw in the backfield. I mean, he does give them a burst. Now, what he does not give them that Brandon Jacobs does is pass protection. So that's worth keeping an eye on if they are going to be throwing the football. Right now, again, Tampa Bay in there with the 8 defenders.
That's Jermaine Phillips, a Troy Circle. The pass to Plexico Burris. Back-to-back catches, and he picks up 9. Rondé Barber on the stop for Tampa Bay. 2nd and 1. Sunday, February 3rd. Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers rock the Super Bowl, the Bridgestone Super Bowl 42 halftime show. Is that Sunday? Only on Fox. Who will have just completed the first half? Will it be New England? Will it be Jacksonville? Will it be Indianapolis? Will it be San Diego, Tennessee? They play later today. On 2nd and 1, a toss to Bradshaw, and he's fighting to get back to the line of scrimmage and just barely did.
Well, and the reason that play wasn't able to go anywhere, Javon Hay was able to stretch that out and get a little bit of pressure, and Ahmad Bradshaw, who wanted to be able to get out on the edge, was unable to do that. And then everybody else came in support to get him on the ground.
Phillips in on that tackle. It's 3rd and 1. They don't run it. Eli throws it and completes it. That's Smith First down, Giants inside the 20. To the 17-yard line, 21 yards on third and one.
Well, I like the call. I mean, third and one, how many times are you going to see them dial up the pass? And, you know, against a team that can get pressure on the quarterback, Kevin Gilbride, the offensive coordinator, dialing it up, and Eli Manning showing a little athleticism within the pocket himself. But Steve Smith, we talked about it a moment ago, you know, he's going to have to be the guy. There's going to be opportunities for him one-on-one in the middle of the field. There's so much attention that's going to be drawn to Plexico Burress. He has to be able to win, and he won on that play.
First down at the 17. More Manning, another completion. And this time it's Bradshaw, who was lined up wide to the right, good for 8 yards.
I like right now what New York is doing. You know, they're still going to stay relatively committed to the running game. I don't think that this team is built to getting completely away from the running game, even if they're not having much success. Continue to run the football, but they're getting their plays right now out of the passing game. And watching Eli Manning, boy, he really looks like he's comfortable right now within the pocket.
So Derek Brooks said, our goal is to make Eli uncomfortable. They have not done that. Second and two. Jacobs, touchdown, New York. On the road, down 7-0. The Giants with the extra point coming. They're trying to score 14 unanswered here as we wind down in the first half.
Yeah, Madison Hedgecock, 265 pounds. He's your lead blocker. And then the guy coming in behind that is also 265 pounds. You see the block that he made. And then before anybody could even get a hand on Jacobs, I mean, you're just not going to be able to slow that train down.
Alford is back in there at center for the kick. Perfect snap, perfect extra point. It's 14-7. Brandon Jacobs weighs more than Gaines Adams, the rookie defensive end, and all the linebackers for the Tampa Bay Bucs. How about this half for Eli Manning? 14-7, Giants. A little burst there, a little lift on that last possession, and Eli Manning, 9 of 10. For 98 yards on the last two drives. How and why the St. Louis Rams cut and got rid of Madison Hedgecock is beyond me. Steven Jackson missed him. The Giants are thrilled to have him, and they locked him up to a 5-year extension after they got him when they realized how good he was at fullback. Spurlock on the return from about the 5. Out across the 25, they'll mark him at the 26, and we go down to the field and Chris Myers.
Joe, what are the factors that that Giant offense was able to move through the Bucs, starting free safety Tanard Jackson, the rookie who started every game and was a terrific player for Monty Kiffin's defense, got a shot to his left knee. He tried to play, was taken out on that series, and is questionable for the remainder of the game at that safety spot. And Joey Galloway in the first quarter took a shot to his left shoulder, same shoulder he hurt a couple of weeks ago in San Francisco, and he has not been moving very smoothly.
All right, Chris, we'll keep an eye on Galloway on this possession as Ernest Graham keeps those legs churning, gets a hit from behind at the end of it, picked up a couple.
You know, Chris talks about that shoulder injury there to Joey Galloway, and it is a factor. I know in visiting with him the other day, you know, his legs feel great. I mean, he's still running as good as he was back when he was 26 years old. He's 36 right now, but the shoulder has really been bothering him. So now he comes into the game, he re-aggravates it, and he's really the one guy that can threaten a defense, and he's the home run threat. So if he can't do that, that's going to impact this offense.
Second and 8, pressure on Garcia, passes low but caught. That's Askew, the fullback. And Askew is going to be brought down after a gain of 5, third and short coming up.
And if his shoulder wasn't sore enough, he's coming off the line here, and he takes a hit there from Jarris Wilkinson. And, you know, those are the things that you try to do against a guy who's more of a speed receiver. Jam him up at the line, bang him around, and not let him get off the ball. So many of his deep completions, and he's had several this year, have come when he's taken the middle of the field.
Third down and 3. Garcia in trouble over the middle, completes first down. Michael Pittman on the catch, a gain of 7.
Well, in order to make that throw, then you've got to be able to block Michael Strahan. We've seen True Blood have some problems, but they go one-on-one with him. Then Davin Joseph comes over to help out with no one to block for himself. And Garcia putting the ball on the money. And on the end of that, then you got to contend with Osa Umanure on the backside. It's one thing to block Strahan, but there's always another guy. And if it's not Osi, then it's Justin Tuck.
Coming up on the two-minute warning, off his back foot and overthrowing Ernest Graham is Garcia. And over the middle of the field, that was a dangerous throw.
You know, nothing ever really looks real easy with Jeff Garcia. And even going back to his days there in San Francisco, and you know, I'm surprised he's made it in the league as long as he has. I don't know that I've ever seen a quarterback take as many hits as what he takes. And sometimes he takes them even when there's pretty good protection, because he gets uncomfortable sitting in the pocket even when protection is good. He likes to be on the move, and sometimes he runs himself right into some pretty big collisions.
Michael Pittman lines up at the top of your screen. Garcia looked left and now flips it forward. And the pass is caught by Ernest Graham, and we're at a minute 59 remaining in the first half. Each side with two timeouts. Third down when we come back for the Bucs. Manning trying to prove something here today in Tampa, Florida. Meanwhile, it's third and eight for the Buccaneers, down by seven with a minute 59 left in the half. Four-man rush. Garcia throws, and the pass is caught. What a grab by Hilliard. That left foot spot is right at the marker. What a catch. We're going to have a measurement after they mark the ball down just inches shy of the 50.
Yeah, what a great catch by him, laying out, being able to make the catch, and then most importantly continue to maintain possession as he went to the ground. You know, John Gruden, in talking with him, he said that he nicknamed Ike Hilliard third and Ike, meaning that's the guy they're looking for whenever it's third down. And he picks up another first down here with a great catch.
So a minute 53 left in the half, and Hilliard, who, as we said, the leading receiver for this Tampa Bay team during the regular season with 62 catches, had just enough.
You can only imagine how important this game is for him, having spent his first 8 years there with the New York Giants. And you know, he didn't talk much about that, but you know, any player, when they get a chance to go up against their former organization, wants to go out and play well and have a good game.
Throw to Smith, and the tight end is upended immediately after a gain of four. Kevin Dockery, Troy, has been bothered by a bad hip, has really been playing well. They were hopeful to get him active for this game, was there on the stop.
Yeah, not having him those last couple of games affected them because of the struggles that Corey Webster has had.
Second and six. Garcia throws left, and it's broken up by Webster. Good play by Corey Webster as he put his right hand in front of Joey Galloway.
That was good coverage there, because he's out there a little bit on an island, and then being able to make a play on the slant. You know, he just read it pretty well. I know the crowd right now is reacting. They were wanting to get pass interference. Maybe he had his left hand on his back, but overall, I thought that was pretty good coverage and a nice play on his part.
The Giants, by the way, who were penalized only 77 times all season, the fewest in franchise history for a 16-game season, have not committed a penalty this half. Garcia with time throws, and broken up a little bit out of the reach of Hilliard, and good play by the rookie Aaron Ross. It's fourth down now as the defense for the Giants comes up with another hold.
Yeah, and Tampa Bay got what they wanted. Ike Hilliard on the rookie Aaron Ross, and he just he doesn't recognize man coverage because he doesn't stay on the move. I mean, anytime as a receiver, when you've got that crossing route shallow and it's man coverage, you never slow down and give the defender a chance to make up ground. And yet he slowed down, I guess not recognizing it was man. Had he have stayed on the run, he should have been able to give more separation and a better lane for Garcia.
So now the Giants will have time. They have two timeouts remaining. as Bidwell punts it to McQuarters, who called for a fair catch inside the 20. And Galloway is going to head into the locker room early next Sunday on Fox. The machines are back, and only a mother's love for her son can save the future. It's the series premiere of Terminator, the Sarah Connor Chronicles. Next Sunday at 8 Eastern, 7 Central, only on Fox. Viewer discretion is advised. So the series premiere next week. And now with a minute 7 remaining and 2 timeouts, we'll see how aggressive the Giants want to be. So far, so good for Manning the last 2 possessions.
And I think they've got to be aggressive.
They start on the ground with Jacobs, who picks up 8.5.
Eli Manning right now looking to the sidelines. He's telling them to huddle up. So, you know, it appears that unless they're able to get a pretty good play here, then they're going to be content, you know, going in up 7 points. But I think with 2 timeouts, especially with that last run, I mean, what a great opportunity they had with Tampa really on the, you know, on their heels a little bit over the last 2 possessions, that, you know, I would have thought that they would have been a little more aggressive, at least in what they've shown right now.
I would agree with you. Eli is 9 for 10 with a touchdown pass the last 2 drives. Jacob slipped, able to get his footing, get the handoff, and he is ridden out of bounds. Although they will keep the clock winding, and that will do it for the first half here in Tampa, Florida. Coming up in the Visa halftime report, Kurt, Terry, Howie, and Jimmy will have first half analysis and a preview of tomorrow's BCS National Championship game between LSU and Ohio State. That's coming your way on the other side of the break. Eli Manning, a solid first half for the Giants, who fell behind 7-0, 14 unanswered points, 14-7 New York at the break.
Brandon Jacobs with a pair of first half touchdowns for the Giants, in New York on the road in Tampa leads this wild card matchup 14-7 at the half. And we welcome you to the Visa Halftime Report. Kurt Menefee along with Terry, Howie, and Jimmy. And this is not exactly the way we expected it to be. We thought defense would reign, but everybody picked Tampa in the pregame show.
Well, what do you want? The crowd's going crazy down in Tampa. As Jeff Garcia, what do you want, the old experienced veteran or the young guy like Eli Manning? It's like my online dating service asked me, veteran or the young guy? Crossing route, Ernest Graham, 14-yard strike. It is no score at this point. 2 plays later, Ernest Grant from 1 yard out, 7-0 Buccaneers over the visiting New York Giants. Remember now, the Giants are 7-1 this year on the road. Manning back. Brandon Jacobs, man-to-man coverage inside, 7-all, Giants and the Buccaneers. Second quarter, Manning back again. Man-to-man coverage. Get inside your guy. You've got room to run. This one to Steve Smith, 21 yards in the first down. Score still tied, 7-all. And then Brandon Jacobs out of the eye. Goes left, back up the middle, breaks 1-2 tackles, 8-yard touchdown run. 14-7, the New York Giants on top of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
You mentioned that 7-1 record. During the regular season on the road, they lost the opening game and have won 7 in a row, trying to carry it over into the playoffs. And Jimmy, if Eli keeps playing like this, there's no reason they can't.
Yeah, we said in the pregame show, you know, which Eli Manning are we going to see? We're seeing the good Eli Manning. And the reason for it, Tampa Bay's approach defensively. They're saying, hey, we're daring you to throw the ball against us. 8-man front, some man-to-man coverage, some 3-deep coverage. And they're taking away the run, but Eli Manning's taking advantage of it, throwing the football.
Yeah, Garcia would like to exploit the secondary. He's been harassed the entire first half except for the first drive. Eli, 9 of 10 on those 2 touchdown drives. Jimmy talked about it. They're daring him to throw the football. He's working the middle of the field, the intermediate routes. He's taking what's there. Came of age versus New England, carrying it over into this football game, not making the bad throw.
Well, and Tampa Bay, listen, if you want to win this football game, you better do something, try 3-step drop, set up, post routes, corners, combination, deep. Get it down the field. Try to explode this thing instead of just sitting there letting everybody pound on you.
Yeah, especially against an injured secondary. Yeah,
of course, exactly. Another half of that game coming up your way in just a bit. But tomorrow night, the big game in the Big Easy, the BCS National Championship Contest. Number 1 Ohio State versus number 2 LSU. Tom Brenneman and Charles Davis will call all the action for us here on Fox. And here they are taking a look at Ohio State's offense against LSU's defense.
Kurt, thank you very much. Yesterday, media day at the Superdome in New Orleans. We'll have our coverage here on Fox beginning tomorrow night at 7:30 Eastern, the All-State BCS National Championship game. Number one, Ohio State against number two, LSU. And Charles, let's start with the Ohio State offense. Pretty much all year long, they threw it well and they ran it well.
And throwing it well was Todd Beckman, a first-year starter who replaced Troy Smith, the Heisman Trophy winner, and they really didn't miss a beat for much of the season. A tall, rangy thrower, Todd Beckman, very accurate, especially on deep passes. His nickname, the Mad Bomber, and he wants to throw a couple in this ball game. But to give them the toughness running the ball, it's Chris Beanie Wells. Number 28 is absolutely dynamic with the ball in his hands. He chewed up Michigan for 222 yards in his last performance.
On defense, though, can they run against a number three ranked unit in the country led by their All-American Glenn Dorsey?
They can only run if they can block Mr. Dorsey. He'll be wearing number 72 in white, the most decorated defensive player in the country this year. If they can't move him, there's no way Ohio State can run the football. And Glenn Dorsey's finally healthy after last month where he battled injuries.
Now, coming up in the AT&T postgame show, we'll flip it around. We'll take a look at LSU's offense against the number one ranked defense in the country, the Ohio State Buckeyes. Which team will be hosting the championship trophy here tomorrow night?
Back to you, Kurt.
Thank you, LSU guys. And as Tom said in the postgame show, we'll flip it around and look at the football the other way, and we'll get your predictions as to who you think will win that game. Except from you, Jimmy.
Cousin Jacob Hester playing in that game.
Well, you can't. Don't tell who you think.
No, I'm just saying it's his third cousin.
We'll all be watching, Jimmy. What are you going to be doing Monday night?
I'm going to be right there on the field, on the action. Hey, calling the game.
Just like always.
You've been outstanding so far. I've watched every
one. I'm all over it.
If there's college football, Jimmy is there. We've got more NFL football coming your way. The second half from Tampa, where the Buccaneers had the lead, but now have to come back.
The Visa Halftime Report is sponsored by Visa, proud sponsor of the NFL. Life takes Visa.
Second half is a couple of minutes away. It was really a tale of two quarters in the first half. First quarter dominated by the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. They jumped out to a 7-0 lead, but all Giants after that. 127 total yards to 29. And for the latest in playoff stats, log on to foxsports.com or nfl.com. Jacobs, two touchdowns in the game. A 14-7 lead for Eli Manning. Second half coming up.
New York Giants on three. One, two, three.
New York Giants.
-72 degree day here in Tampa, Florida. 14-7, the Giants on top and about to kick to John Gruden and his offense. As we begin the second half, Tynes will kick it away. Spurlock takes it in from about the 7. Room to run. Lost the football, and it is recovered by New York Webster. First Tynes had his hands on it, then Webster came away with a fumble recovery and a huge turnover here by Spurlock.
Well, there's no question, Joe, Spurlock is the one who had the return a few weeks ago for the touchdown, but you know, young guy comes in and you know, both coaches talked about how critical the turnover game was going to be. You come out in the second half, you think your offense is going to get the ball, try to get something going, only to give a short field to this New York Giants team.
Tynes had a shot at a fumble recovery, but Webster was there to pick it up after Tank Daniels forced the fumble. And here is that Giant offense, and here is Brandon Jacobs. A 7-yard gain on first down. First it was Tynes, the kicker.
Well,
and then it was Webster. Wow.
Well, that shows you what the kickers do during the week in practice. They don't practice recovering fumbles. Pretty athletic move, though. He rolled up on his head. And he must have been a gymnast back in the day, huh?
That was the first turnover of the game.
Kickers never get a break.
Second and 3. Jacobs will try the right side, and Brandon has a first down inside the 20. Picked up four. Buchanan on the tackle for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and what an opportunity here for the Giants on the road. They get the turnover on the kick return by Spurlock, and they have a chance now to cram it right into the end zone.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, obviously that's what's important for New York. I mean, to get a chance to make it a two-possession game, a touchdown here would be huge for them just because of the way that the defense has been able to contain Tampa Bay offensively. But, you know, this is a critical series right now for this defense.
On first down, they stick with a ground game and run it with Brandon Jacobs, who picks up a yard. Derek Brooks on the tackle for the Buccaneers. Second down and 9. What a difference a year makes for John Gruden's team. Last year, minus 12 in the turnover margin. This year, plus 15. And a big reason why they ended up winning the NFC South. But a turnover on special teams has presented this opportunity to the Giants. Manning keeps it. Chased out of the pocket, throws too high, tipped and incomplete. Had Boss wide open. And Manning knows he missed one there. Third down and 9.
You know, I like the play action here by Kevin Gilbride after they've gotten the running game going. Now they go off tackle, fake, roll Eli out to his right. You know, they had two receivers in the same area. Initially, I thought maybe he was trying to go to Plexico Burris on the back of the end zone. And then Boss was, he got his hand on it. I'm not sure really, Joe, who exactly it was that he was trying to get the football to. Normally, you don't see two receivers like that stacked so close.
They're down and 9 now. Manning, a screen for Jacobs. Well-designed play, and Jacobs has a first down for the Giants. Knocked down at the 8, and he is a load coming in the open field with a ball in his hands.
I tell you, he got the ball, and he had two blockers out in front of him, and these blockers didn't have anywhere to go. I mean, there was no defenders out in front. You see there with Jacobs with the ball in his hand. And then finally, they're able to come up and make a play, but not until after they pick up the first down. You know, I think Kevin Gilbride has done a good job as offensive coordinator, really mixing things up, sticking with the running game even when it wasn't working, mixing in some play action, and then the screen game's been pretty good for him.
On first and goal, this one for Burris, and overthrown. Plexico Burris is 6 or 7 inches taller than any cornerback that the Tampa Bay Buccaneers can run out there, and so trying to take advantage of Phillip Buchanan. He's 5'11". Burris is 6'5". That one was just thrown too high.
Yeah, I mean, you want to throw it more like an alley-oop like you would in basketball. I mean, you can't throw that on a line, and you got to give him an opportunity because as long as you get it up high enough, you know, he's going to have a real shot at coming down with it.
Now Burris will be at the bottom of the screen across from Rondae Barber. Brandon Jacobs and penalty flags prior to the snap. So that play blown dead. Here's Walt Anderson.
False start, number 67, offense. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
That is the first penalty called against the Giants in this game.
Yeah, the Giants, you know, in previous years, they had really struggled with penalties, Joe. This year, the 6th least penalized team in the National Football League.
With a franchise record, as we said earlier, 143 2 years ago. Only 77 this season. Second and goal. With a ball at the 13-yard line. Manning over the middle hits Toomer. And Amani Toomer gets it down inside the 5 where it'll be third and goal.
Well, they've really had a lot of success working the middle of the field there, whether it's been Amani Toomer or Steve Smith. You know, that shallow crossing route has been real good to them, whether they've been in man coverage or even zone. You know, in zone coverage, these linebackers get depth. It opens things up in that area. This is a tough area, though, on the field right here on third down to throw the football. Not an easy place to run the football either.
Play clock at one. And that's a delay of game. That doesn't help. That play never happened. That play is blown dead because Eli Manning took too long at the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, and Eli's had a few of those happen to him over the course of this season.
Prior to the snap, delay of game, offense, 5-yard penalty, it's still third down.
You know, sometimes, Joe, it's okay to take a delay of game penalty, but you got to know when the situation warrants doing that. It does not warrant that when you're inside the 5-yard line trying to go in for a touchdown. And so now, already difficult enough to try to get a touchdown on third down from where they were, but now, you know, from where they're at, even more difficult. And you know, you just got to watch the clock. As the quarterback, when you break the huddle, the first thing you got to do is see how much time's left on the play clock.
Ball back at the 9, third and goal. Manning slings it. Smith, nowhere to go. Brian Kelly on the tackle, and the Tampa Bay defense makes enough plays to keep the Giants out of the end zone.
They really did. I mean, that's a nice job by that defensive unit and Monty Kiffin and them, you know, tightening up and not allowing a touchdown, because so many times when you give the ball to an offense where the Giants got to start that possession, they get a touchdown. There's nowhere in the rule book that says that the offense has to score a touchdown, and Tampa Bay steps up and holds them to a field goal attempt. It's a nice job on their part.
25-yard try for Times. Fiegels gets it down, and Tynes drives it through. A drive that started after a special teams turnover by Michael Spurlock, recovered by Webster. Good play on third down by the Bucs defense to keep the Giants out of the end zone. It's a 10-point New York lead. Lawrence Tynes hits the 25-yarder. The Giants put up 17 unanswered points. Tank Daniels forced the fumble from Michael Spurlock, who is back to have another crack at it. From the 10. Spurlock hangs on to the football as he is rolling down. They'll mark him at the 30. 20-yard return, drones on the tackle. Garcia back to work down 10. There's how the possessions have ended.
At the 30.
During the time the Bucs have had the ball, Garcia has been throwing short, as Jimmy Johnson talked about at the half. Last 7 completions have all been under 10 yards. Ernest Graham carries it. Nice run on first down. Picked up 5. Let's go down to Pam Oliver.
Well, Joe, Tom Coughlin was already pleased with his team's overcoming that slow start to begin the game, but he's even more pleased now, I would imagine. He did tell me at halftime, if we can get a couple of quick scores, we can then defensively put Jeff Garcia in a position he does not want to be in, make him do some things he does not want to do. Heat was an issue coming into this game. The Giants were worried about it. A couple of players got IVs at the half, but otherwise everybody's fine. Back to you.
All right, Pam, thank you. It's Graham again. And Graham does not go down easily. He's about a 1/2 yard shy of a first down. OC Human Ura on the tackle for the Giants.
You know, I think to follow up on what Pam said, I mean, when you look at this Tampa Bay Buccaneer team and the way they have operated all season long, not surprising then that Coughlin would want to get a few scores. I mean, this is a team that when they've been behind at halftime is only 1-6. I mean, it's not a team that really comes back. That's not the way that they're built. You know, I know that, you know, the studio show talked about it at halftime as far as, you know, taking some shots. I think that's what Tampa Bay needs to do.
All 3 carries by Graham. They're going to mark Graham back at the 40. Giants are saying they got the football. No indication from the officials that there was a fumble. And it depends on the spot as to whether it's enough for a first down.
Advance to the line of gain. First down.
There you go. Down by contact, no fumble, and in advance of the line to gain, first down, Tampa Bay.
Yeah, as we take a look at it, I thought that was the right spot there with the first down. It looked to me like he had picked up the first down. But right now, if you look at what the Giants are doing defensively, I mean, they're challenging these guys a little bit, challenging the wide receivers. Tampa Bay has been very conservative within the passing game. At some point, you got to take a shot.
Over the middle, Graham again, and a penalty flag comes in. Back in the area where Garcia ended up on the grass, Graham gets 5. Let's get the call. Now Jairus Wilkinson, who is playing in place of the injured Kavika Mitchell, can't get up.
Personal foul. Roughing the passer, number 96, defense. 15-yard penalty, first down.
That's Barry Cofield, who gets the call for this hit up high and into the face of Garcia.
Yeah, that was a tough one because he you know, normally they give you two steps, but because it was so close and came to the head, you know, that's why they called it, and they're going to call that every time.
Ball is at the Giants 40 for Tampa Bay, down 10. Jairus Wilkinson appears to be okay. He popped up and got off the field under his own power. That's good news for the Giants. They're thin at linebacker. Kavika Mitchell, who sprained his knee last week against the Patriots, is out there at the moment. First down for the Buccaneers at the Giants 40. Pittman starts his play lined up at the bottom of your screen, and Ernest Graham carries it for another Tampa Bay first down. Jabril Wilson on the tackle, but not before Graham got 10.
Yeah, it's been a nice drive right now for Ernest Graham. I mean, they really weren't able to get a lot going in the running game there in the first half. Now this being their first possession of the second half, Ernest Graham on those first three carries, pretty tough sledding for him, but this time the offensive line doing a pretty good job of creating a hole for him, and it gives our viewers a chance, for those who haven't had a chance to watch him play this year, the type of ability he has. I mean, as I said, not real flashy, but he keeps moving forward.
All six plays on this drive have been Ernest Graham. Five runs and a reception. Let's go down to the field and check in with Chris Myers.
John, the Bucs sideline, John Gruden, in that Gruden-esque tone, told his team to get more physical, and he said he wasn't happy with the pressure the four-man rush of the Giants were getting, and he would make adjustments in the running game so that Jeff Garcia could plant his feet. And he did say, he confirmed that Joey Galloway did re-aggravate that shoulder, and Gruden is aggravated. He said Galloway will be out there, but he won't be 100%.
Ernest Graham at the bottom of your screen. Split wide to the right.
Legal.
And this is for Galloway, and picked off, an easy pick by Webster. Poor decision and throw by Jeff Garcia, and great defensive position for Corey Webster.
Yeah, it's a little bit like what we saw earlier in the game. Corey Webster had inside position on Joey Galloway, and you got to see that as the quarterback. You either lay it up to the outside, but you can't throw a flat ball to the inside.
Toss to Bradshaw, running left. Picks up a yard and a half. That's it. Back to the interception.
Yeah, let's take a look at the route again. And Joey Galloway is going to get pushed outside. And this is a problem for a quarterback trying to put the ball to where he can make a play. There's just nowhere to put it. Corey Webster inside looking back. And you can see the trajectory of that ball. It's a pretty flat throw there by Garcia. And Joey Galloway didn't even have a chance to make a play. But I got to tell you, Webster's doing a great job. If somebody would have said they're going to play Joey Galloway man-to-man with Corey Webster, Tampa Bay would have been pretty excited about that matchup.
Second down and 8. Manning with time. Throws low. A penalty flag comes in the area of a hold. They throw it at the feet of Snee, and it is a hold. Boss was underthrown.
Holding, number 76, offense. 10-yard penalty. It's still second down.
So that is three penalties here in a short amount of time for the Giants, after going through the entire first half without a penalty.
You're going to see him right in the middle there. Yeah.
Second down and 18. Hand off to Bradshaw underneath out of the shotgun, and Bradshaw gets to the 15. That's it. It'll be third down and 15 after that carry. Derek Brooks on the stop with just over 5 to play in the third quarter. The divisional playoffs will be next weekend on Fox. NFC side, we know that Seattle, after their 35-14 win yesterday, will be at Green Bay, Lambeau Field, taking on Brett Favre. And the winner of this game will be at Dallas late, 4 o'clock Eastern. They fake the handoff. Manning pulls it back and now underthrows Ahmad Bradshaw. Troy, Ahmad Bradshaw was all alone over there, and if Eli Manning gets that ball up at all, it's an easy first down.
You know, he had so much time in the pocket to look at where he wanted to go with the football. Initially, he wants to go down the middle of the field there to Toomer. Then he looks to the left, and he pulls off of it. But you're right, had he made a good throw, look at all that room out there where he had. Had he have been able to get the ball to where Ahmad Bradshaw could have made the complete or made the catch. I mean, amazing that you could drop a ball off that shallow and still have that kind of room to pick up a first down, but it would have happened.
Fiegels booms one. Hilliard can't get his hands on a good punt by Jeff Fiegels. Out of bounds at the 33. What an opportunity for the Giants and Manning on third and 15. Coughlin trying to keep his team up. They lead by 10. Buccaneers do not have a Pro Bowler, and that's saying something when you've got a guy like Derrick Brooks who made 10 straight Pro Bowls coming into this season. Not on the list as Graham carries it and goes nowhere. Picks up a yard. That's it. And again, as we told you, it will be Seattle at Green Bay on Saturday at 3:30 Eastern on Fox next weekend. And then on Sunday, it's either the Giants or the Buccaneers at the Cowboys, the number one seed, Sunday at 4 Eastern.
Yeah, and congratulations to Seattle and their big win yesterday. And even congratulations to the Washington Redskins. It's never easy when the season ends. And for what they have been through and the winning streak that they carried going into yesterday's game, and Todd Collins. I mean, a great story and a great job by them.
Pressure on Garcia, who drops it off to Askew. And a good tackle by Wilkinson. Chasing it down from the backside, a gain of 7.
Antonio Pierce, he's able to get some pressure, and right now the Giants are not respecting this passing game of Tampa Bay's, and so they're bringing pressure. They're playing outside one-on-one, and you know, Garcia having to get the ball out pretty quick. You know, it's pretty remarkable when you look at how the Giants are playing them, and they haven't been able to take advantage of it. I know Jeff Garcia felt coming in, if we can block it up and they're going to play man-to-man on the outside, I really think we have a lot of good answers, but so far they haven't shown any.
Third down and 2, play action from Garcia, who has time and hits his tight end Smith. And Alex with a first down at the 43-yard line of the Giants.
And that might be the area where they're going to have to start working, is Alex Smith and then maybe even Jeremy Stevens. And Alex Smith, he's an athletic tight end. He runs good routes. Nice route there. And then Garcia hanging with him, knowing where that window was for him to get the ball to him. Just a nice job of execution. But you know, running the football, we've seen Ernest Graham. He's had some success here in the second half, but they're going to have to make some plays in this passing game.
Longest completion all game for Garcia, 15 yards on 3rd and 2, and now a handoff to Graham. He picks up a yard and a half. Coming up on 2 minutes left in this third quarter, and the Giants know they can't go to sleep on Garcia. First-year defensive coordinator Steve Spagnuolo done a great job with this aggressive front for this Giants defense. Garcia with time down the middle, and this one incomplete. Galloway, the intended receiver, and a lot of pressure by Strahan on Jeff Garcia.
You know, they try to run this play action and then, you know, get Galloway across the field. This is really where they've had a lot of their success, and you know, he's going to go to the post. And it just doesn't look like he's running like I'm accustomed to seeing him run. I don't know if he just gave up on the route, not thinking Garcia was going to be able to get it to him or not. And then Garcia, it was bad enough when you're not able to complete a pass. When you take a hit after an incompletion like that, those seem to hurt a little bit more.
Galloway, who's never won in the playoffs, 1 catch, 9 yards, and that one is almost picked off by Michael Johnson. He's a rookie and a backup safety. And an extra defensive backs package with a pass intended for Galloway. Johnson almost came away with a Giants second pick.
Yeah, they're pretty fortunate there. And what's happened is New York is pretty much sitting at the first down markers, knowing that Tampa Bay hasn't been able to get anything down the field, and so they're going to sit on those routes, and that's why Johnson had a chance for an interception.
A minute 47 left in the third quarter. Those are the football pointed down, and Bidwell hits it. Fair catch called by R.W. McQuarters. It's down at the 8. And so inside our broadcast booth, we size up what we've seen. We talked about the inexperience of the Tampa Bay offensive line. They've done a decent job against that Giants pass rush. And I would say to this point, Eli Manning has outplayed Jeff Garcia.
Yeah, I think that's fair, and nothing real flashy even with Eli Manning, but he's been very efficient and very effective, and he's taken what the defense has given him. He's made some poor throws. They could have gotten a little bit more, but right now with his play, and you combine that with how resilient this Giants defense has been, that's why they're leading the way that they are.
Yeah, the defense has had a good day so far. From the 8, Manning underneath. He hits Hedgecock, the fullback, and Madison is out to the 12, brought down by Jermaine Phillips. On Sunday, February 10th, Sunday following the Super Bowl, the all-stars of the NFL come to Fox. Don't miss the 2008 NFL Pro Bowl presented by State Farm live from Hawaii on Sunday, February 10th, only on Fox. Second and 6. Manning's going to air it out for Burris, and Burris with a hand, he may get offensive pass interference. Phillip Buchanan was back there, and Burris is the one that grabbed Buchanan.
Yeah, you're exactly right. Buchanan was in good position. You know, we've seen awfully good cornerback play here today.
Number 17, offense. Half the distance to the goal. It's still second down.
And a little bit like what we were talking about with Tampa Bay offensively, same thing happens here. You know, they're one-on-one. Burris has a chance. You saw the arm there on Buchanan. You know, pretty good call there by the official. You can't, you know, the defense can't do that, and the receiver can't do that either. You know, Plexico Burris has been able to make some big plays, but he's not really a speed guy. I mean, he can't run like he used to be able to because of the injured ankle. And so the ball's got to be more on him and let him try to make a play on it going up high.
Second and 11. Handoff is to Jacobs. He's down at the 11. Third down coming up for the Giants, and they will have to snap the ball one more time before the end of this quarter.
And I think this is a pretty big third down right now for Tampa Bay. I mean, considering the fact that they're down 10 points and they're going to be going into the fourth quarter, if they're able to make a stop here, they should give the ball to their offense with awfully good field position. And you'd think, you know, one or two first downs by that Tampa Bay offense, they would at least then be able to get 3 points and cut it to a one-score game.
Ryan Neese, who's starting for the injured Cato June, limps off the field. Play clock at 2:01. Eli just gets it away. Manning pulls it down, throws, completes. Toomer, first down. And that's the way the third quarter will end, with the Giants up 17-7 and converting on third down. A patient Eli Manning completes for 11 yards to Amani Toomer. First down, New York, up 10 when the fourth quarter starts. Back after this from your local Fox station. The Giants carry a 10-point lead here on the road as we start the fourth quarter. First down at their own 22. Ahmad Bradshaw carries, stays on his feet, gets a big hit from Phillips, loses his helmet, and fights for extra yardage up to the 29. Let's go down to Pam Oliver. Pam.
Well, Joe, we may have our first heat casualty today. David Deal is on the sideline, really putting in a whole lot of electrolytes, drinking Gatorade. He's trying to stretch out his right leg. Maybe some cramping situation there. Back to you.
All right, thank you. So, Pam, we will take a look at that huddle and look at the Giants. Guy Wimper has taken over at left tackle. And only two backups remain on the offensive line on the sideline for the Giants. Coates and Booth. Play action from Manning, who fires high but caught by Toomer. First down at the 40. Buchanan on the tackle for the Buccaneers.
You know, nice job by Amani Toomer setting the defensive back up, coming back to the ball. Phillip Buchanan in coverage, and again, one-on-one, and you know, puts his foot in the ground and comes back. And so many times you see receivers, once the ball's in the air, they wait on it rather than working back to the quarterback. Toomer does not, and that's one of the reasons why it was such an easy completion.
Toomer's always been, Troy, a security blanket for Eli Manning. He has 6 catches in this game.
He throws it with a lot more confidence when he's going to 81.
Bradshaw hits the hole hard. He's not a big guy, Bradshaw. 5'9", 198, had that big game at Buffalo. 17 carries, 151 yards, and a touchdown in that win over the Bills, which clinched a playoff spot for the Giants.
Well, I tell you, Brandon Jacobs, who's been their workhorse all season long, I mean, he's not really been able to get anything going in this ball game. But Ahmad Bradshaw, you know, when they've put him in, you know, you can see how hard he's running. You called it, Joe. Not a real big guy, but I tell you, he is running very, very physical right now. And I think he's created a little bit of a spark for this Giants offense.
And they stay with him on 2nd and 4. Picks his way for a first down. Impressive running by Bradshaw, the rookie. And now we go down to Chris Myers on the sideline.
Well, Joe, the heat affecting the home team as well. You mentioned Ryan Neese. He had cramps, so requiring an IV to replenish fluids. They hope to get him back in the game. Also, Devin Joseph on the offensive line had to go to the locker room for an IV for the Bucs as well. And safety Tanar Jackson is out with the knee injury. It happened in the second quarter. He's been unable to return. And between Pearson and other replacements, Will Allen, that's an area that Eli and the Giants appear to be attacking.
Yeah, look at Pearson cramping up on this hot day, high humidity. Eli rolls out, hits his tight end. And Boss picks up 11.
You know, Kevin Gilbride has been doing is run the football, and then let's run the boot off the backside. I mean, just good play calling there. And then you've got Boss, who sets in the hole. Initially, he's blocking. You can see his shoulder pad came out of his jersey, and then he sets down in the hole. And for a young guy, I mean, Kevin Boss replacing Jeremy Shockey has been awfully impressive. And there's Kevin Gilbride, who I think has called an excellent ball game today.
Boss, who played Division II college football at Western Oregon, stepping into the hole vacated by the injury to Shockey and doing a nice job. Passes low and incomplete. So if we came on the air, Troy, talking about the difference with the way these two teams approach that final weekend, there is no doubt now in my mind that the Giants got a lot out of even that loss at home to the New England Patriots, where they took them to the wall, while the Tampa Bay Buccaneers elected to rest everybody the last game and a half. And whether you look at Garcia or moving the ball offensively, Galloway, they have not looked sharp at all.
Well, I do think that both coaches took the right approach. I think John Gruden resting guys was important for his football team, but I don't think there's any denying what the Giants got out of last week's game has carried over here today.
10th play of the drive, and what a throw from Manning. A back shoulder throw to Plexico Burris. That was beautiful and really impossible to defend.
Well, and the reason it works, remember back a couple plays ago when they were over the top on him and he got called for offensive pass interference? Well, if the defender is going to stay over the top, then the next thing you go to is the back shoulder throw, because he can't play both. If he's going to play the deep ball, he can't play the back shoulder fade. And a good job of recognizing that, calling it up, and then completing it.
Burris had some words for Rondé Barber during the week. Those two have been hooked up a lot today as Bradshaw tries to find some running room. Boy, he's been great. To the 15-yard line, and he got 6 yards when it looked like there'd be nothing.
Yeah, what was it? Plexico Burris said that Rondé Barber shouldn't worry so much about Eli Manning. He better worry about 17. And, you know, 17 starting to make some plays here.
That was on the response to Rondé Barber saying, of course we want to play the Giants, on his radio show. They win ugly. Shockey's hurt, and Eli is inconsistent. Well, he wasn't inconsistent last week against the Patriots, and he's been even better here today. Hasn't turned the ball over to this very good Tampa Bay defense. 2nd and 4. Bradshaw. Ahmad Bradshaw has a first down. at the 9, and the offensive line banged up as it is without O'Hara, without David Deal. They are moving people out.
Yeah, I mean, you just look at the movement here with these guys. I mean, it's awfully nice. And then Ahmad Bradshaw, because he does have such quickness, you know, he's able to make people miss. You got a guy in the hole, and he's not able to make the play. You know, Brandon Jacobs, he certainly has a lot of elusiveness for a big guy, but not nearly to the extent that Ahmad Bradshaw has.
That was the injured center, Sean O'Hara, cheering on the offensive line, doing a job, first and goal. Bradshaw again. This time, Barber comes up from his corner spot to make the play, a gain of only 1 at second and goal.
When you look at where this drive began on the Giants' 8-yard line, I mean, this has been awfully impressive. You know, they've taken over 7 minutes off the clock. I mean, just doing a good job.
And how about this balanced attack? A game that has been brilliantly called by Kevin Gilbride. And Bradshaw now has been more of the difference maker than Brandon Jacobs. Second and goal. Just chewing up the clock. Bradshaw again makes a move in the hole and gets it down inside the 5. Picked up 4.
You know, these are really signature drives that you want to have as an offensive unit. I mean, when you get into a game like this and you're up 10 points and you have a chance to go from your 8-yard line and drive the football, complete some passes, run the ball effectively as they have with Ahmad Bradshaw, and take that kind of time off the clock and then score to really put that game away. I mean, this is an excellent job that we're seeing from the New York Giants. Not so good for Tampa Bay defensively.
8 runs, 6 passes. 15th play of the drive. Touchdown, Giants. Amani Toomer. And a brilliant drive engineered by Manning, anchored by Bradshaw on the ground and called by Gilbride on the sideline.
Yeah, and I don't want to overstate this drive, Joe, by any means, but you know, that's a heck of a job right there by Eli Manning, as you said, directing this drive, getting him down here into a position to throw the touchdown pass. And you know, who knows, whatever happens, but we may be looking back at some point in time on this drive for Eli Manning and say, you know what, that's when he really grew up.
Toomer, 7 catches, 74 yards and a touchdown. And here on the road, the New York Giants have scored 24 unanswered points. A little pump fake, a look left, a throw to his right, and Eli has a smile and another touchdown. Well, after jumping out to a 7-0 lead, the Buccaneers had that good first quarter, and since then it has literally been all Giants, both offensively and defensively. Lawrence Tynes, by the way, has been dealing with cramps in his legs prior to this kick, but he booms it, and Spurlock will take it from about the 4. He's put the ball on the ground today, and Webster, who's been all over the place, forces Spurlock out, and there's a penalty flag. How about Amani Toomer, who's in his 12th year?
During the return, holding number 26, receiving team. 10-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down, timeout.
There is not much going right for John Gruden's team. A hug from Burris to Amani Toomer, and Eli Manning pumped up one of his biggest days of his young career. The Giants offense has taken apart the number 2 ranked defense in the NFL. It's where the Buccaneers ended the season. Joey Galloway is on the sideline, bothered by that shoulder, and here are the Buccaneers down by 17, and there's a throw that was intended for Ike Hilliard. Coverage on the play by Dockery. Here's a Tampa offense, Troy, that is only averaging 3.3 yards per play, and their biggest gain on one play all game is 14 yards. So everything, even when they've completed balls, everything has been close to the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, and that really, I mean, has been their problem for a number of years. They just not had a lot of big play threats. Joey Galloway has been that guy. Now that he's on the sidelines, they really don't have anyone.
Second down and 10. Garcia throws, and the pass is complete. Short of a first down. That's Hilliard, good for 9. And let's go down to the sideline.
All right, Joe, Jeff Garcia has played just one quarter of football in the last two games coming in. There was some chatter about the timing. Would he be a little rusty despite the season he had? It's something that they're discussing over here on the Bucs sideline. Probably more credit to the Giant defense and the pressure that they've been able to put on Jeff Garcia.
All right, Chris, thank you. Third down and one. It's Ernest Graham, and it's a first down for the Buccaneers. Well, Jeff Garcia has had late game heroics in the postseason against the Giants, January of 03. He and the 49ers rallied from 24 points down, second biggest comeback in postseason history, to win 39-38. We'll take that same kind of effort if he's going to get up off the mat and beat the Giants here today. That's Stevens, the big tight end, who hasn't been used at all today, has the catch good for 5 yards.
You know, I know we came into this game talking about Jeff Garcia and then his lack of playing time here over the last 5 weeks, but you know, he was injured is why he missed two of those games. And you know, I know it's going to be discussed even after this game ends, but I don't know that John Gruden really could have approached it any differently than what he did. And I agree with what you said, Joe. This has not been a great offensive performance by Jeff
False
Garcia.
Start, number 65, offense. 5 yard penalty, second down.
Or for this offense for that matter, but yeah, I think it has more to do, as you said, with this Giants defense. They've done a great job, and you know, Steve Spagnuolo and that defensive staff, they deserve the credit for the job that they've done, as opposed to Jeff Garcia being rusty.
Second down and 10 after the penalty. That's Ernest Graham out of the backfield, and they're trying to dink and dunk their way down the field with just over 6 minutes to play. That's good for six, and Pierce on the tackle, and Graham gets up hobbling off to the sideline.
I'll tell you what, Joe, the other guy, the other group that really deserves credit in this whole thing is this secondary for the New York Giants. I mean, really amazing. Everybody knows the front seven for the Giants is a very good group. The weak link in everybody's opinion has been this secondary, and they have been. I mean, New England exploited it last week, but they have really done a good job. Now they're going to be tested next week against Dallas.
If they can hang on here, that's Pittman. And Pittman with a first down out to the 39-yard line. Time is definitely the Buccaneers' enemy, and now Michael Strahan is having a tough time getting up. Strahan was not available last year during the postseason, was injured with a bad foot, did not play against Philadelphia, took that shot up high, and they look at Strahan as he tries to stretch out. We'll take a break. Still checking on Strahan over on the sideline. He did get up and get off the field relatively easily, so it doesn't appear to be too serious, but Dave Tollefson takes over at left end defensively for the Giants. First down, Buccaneers down by 17. Garcia, and there's Tollefson.
No.
And we'll get the call as to whether Garcia got the pass away. He did. No sack for Tollefson, but good pressure. And it's second and 10.
Yeah, I mean, it's really amazing. Here you bring in Dave Tollefson right here, 71, and then he does his job on Alex Smith. They got two guys working him, and he's able to come underneath and make a sack. And yeah, you just want, I mean, all these pass rushers that they've got, O.C. Umanura, Justin Tuck, Strahan, and now Tollefson off the bench.
They did rule incomplete pass, but good pressure. Now Garcia gets loose and hits Pittman out of the backfield. Running almost parallel with the line of scrimmage was Garcia, and the play good for 25 yards, biggest of the day for the Buccaneers. Michael Johnson on the stop as Pittman got the ball just outside the Giants 35.
Yeah, and that's really what they needed. I mean, they needed to get a big chunk, and they were able to get it on that last play.
Blitz from the Giants, pass complete to Clayton. Lowers his head and gets it down to the 20. First down, Tampa Bay. Under five to play, 15 yards for Michael Clayton.
And the Giants have seen this act before, you know, going back to that game against San Francisco, and I know a number of players weren't around, but you know, this is not new territory for Jeff Garcia by any means.
Garcia throws, Hilliard on the catch. Hilliard was a part of the Giants back then. And now that they're in the red zone, they fire the cannons after an 8-yard completion to Ike Hilliard.
Banjo.
Second down and a yard and a half. Hand off underneath. That's Pittman again, and he sets up first and goal from the six.
Now you see it so many times, an offense that has been struggling, and then all of a sudden they get into a no-huddle offense, and they just look like an entirely different unit. You know, and you wonder why maybe they didn't get into it a little bit earlier, but you know, it's not a big part of what most teams do, but it certainly has given this team a little bit more life. Now, clearly the Giants, the one thing they have been trying to protect on this series is giving up the big play.
Garcia looking left all the way, hits the tight end Smith, touchdown Buccaneers. And with 3:25 left and the extra point coming, about to make it a 10-point game. The Buccaneers have not won a playoff game since they were in and won the Super Bowl 5 years ago. The Giants have not won a playoff game in 7 years since they were in and lost the Super Bowl to the Ravens. And a strong catch, staying on his feet, is Smith. And now Matt Bryant, who was with the Giants in that collapse out in San Francisco, knocks through the extra point for the Buccaneers. It's 24-14. So it has taken a while. They haven't scored since early in the game. Garcia and the offense into the end zone. Now down by 10. Beautiful day, but too bad you two didn't sing a song called It's a Humid Day, because these are two sidelines that are gasping for breath, fighting it out here for a trip to take on the Dallas Cowboys. And now the Giants expect the onside kick. At some point you figure the Buccaneers are going to have to attempt one, and will they do it right here? Only Ruben Drones is waiting deep, and he will receive the kickoff. So Drones makes it to the 30 and beyond, and that's where the Giants offense will have it, up by 10. 17-yard return by Drones. 77-degree day. Humidity is down since we started, but still 57%. And a reason why there are multiple players on each sideline getting fluids trying to replenish. So Brandon Jacobs has been doing a lot of that, Troy. He's been watching while Ahmad Bradshaw has taken over at running back for the Giants here in the second half.
And what a great job Ahmad Bradshaw has done. And you know, we all know that Brandon Jacobs, he is the guy, but you know, it's nice when you can come in. They haven't had that. Derek Ward went down. Ruben Drones has been filling in some, but Ahmad Bradshaw, he's carved himself out a nice role.
Bradshaw gets it, almost broke it. Gets it out to the 39 and a half. Javon Hay on the tackle, a gain of 7. Don't forget that on Sunday, February 3rd, it's Super Bowl Sunday, and Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers will rock the Super Bowl, the Bridgestone Super Bowl 42. Halftime show is Sunday, February 3rd, only on Fox.
Yeah, I think you got to be pretty happy if you're Tom Coughlin and you come into this game and you say, hey, you know, turnovers are key. We cannot turn the ball over. And that's something that has plagued the Giants at various times. And, you know, they've been smart. Eli Manning doing a great job all day long protecting the football and keeping it out of danger's way.
Each side with all three of their timeouts remaining, and Bradshaw gets back to the line of scrimmage. And
Bradshaw on the run.
Now on 3rd and 3, the Buccaneers will spend one of their three timeouts.
This is the first charge timeout.
You know, I think in this game, Troy, the defense for Tampa Bay made the decision that just about any defense would make in this situation. Eli Manning 0-for-2 in playoff games in years past. They said, okay, we're going to load up against the run. If Eli Manning can beat us, we're going to have our hands full. And Eli Manning has done his part.
He's done that. You know, I mean, he has had the help of a running game. They've been smart in the way that they've called the game. Kevin Gilbride, as we talked about, has done that. But, you know, Eli Manning, I mean, he really, coming off last week's game, stepped in here today and has played very, very well. Without him managing this team the way that he was able to, I don't think they're in this position. Now, I'm curious right here, if you're Tom Coughlin and you're Kevin Gilbride, what are you going to do here on 3rd down? I think you've got to play to pick up this 1st down. I think you got to throw it, play action or something, but I don't think you can get conservative and just run it. This is a
This is a key first down right now for the New York Giants. Third down and three. They do keep it on the ground. Bradshaw will not get it. I would say the only argument after Hovann was the first one in there, the only argument against running it, or rather throwing instead of running, make Tampa Bay use their second timeout for sure, and you're up by 10 points. So you're up by a touchdown and a field goal. It's a little different than if it was a one-score game.
I agree with that to a point, Joe, but I think that if you trust your quarterback that he can make a good decision and throw the football where it's either going to be a first down or it's not. And I think the fact that it is a 10-point game, now you're not as worried about Tampa Bay having to burn, you know, that second timeout, and you can afford yourself to be a little bit more aggressive.
You look at the quarterback comparison, and obviously Eli Manning, who was looking for his first postseason win, has outplayed Jeff Garcia. Eli's brother Peyton, by the way, his first 5 years in the league was 0-3 in the postseason before he won his first January game in 06. Year six. And this is Hilliard, who makes the catch, spins, but cannot get away from Zach Diassi. And Zach was the long snapper for the punt. Now with 2:10 remaining, the Buccaneers will have the football at their own 27, down by 10.
Yeah, and I think that the Giants defensively have to approach this the way they did that last possession as well. I mean, you look at the last possession when Tampa Bay was able to go down the field and get the touchdown, they took over 4 minutes off the clock. And so, you know, defensively, yeah, they'll give up the underneath throws, come up and make a tackle, but the last thing that they can afford to do with 2:10 left in this ball game and up by 10 is give up a big play down the field and allow Tampa to score very quickly.
And quite frankly, the Buccaneers haven't proven that they can do that all day. Garcia over the middle. Pittman out of the backfield makes the catch, and that will take us to the 2-minute warning. So a first down for the Buccaneers, down by 10, the ball at their own 44. Garcia trying to do it again to the Giants, down by 10. Oh. And Grafton, Mass ought to be awfully proud in his first year as defensive coordinator, the way his defense has played today for New York. This one downfield and incomplete, nearly picked off by R.W. McQuarters. Could not get both feet down in bounds as the pass was intended for Clayton.
I'll tell you what, Justin Tuck on the back end there just nailed Jeff Garcia. And good call, you know, was not able to get his feet down. But here's the tail end of that, and he takes a pretty good shot going to the ground. You know, Justin Tuck has, you know, really turned himself into a heck of a football player. While Michael Strahan was holding out, you know, he got his opportunities and has made the most of them. And you mentioned Steve Spagnuolo, Joe, and, you know, think back to...
They're going to have a booth review on that interception. It certainly looked at first pass like McQuarters didn't get both feet down, but there is the left and the right. He may have gotten both feet down. Let's take another look at this angle. The catch is secured, left foot down, right toes. If that's deemed to be in bounds,
yeah, I think
in essence,
that was
the game's over.
Yeah, I think that toe was in from what we saw on this angle here. The left's down, and then that toe was in. So, yeah, that's an interception.
McQuarters is getting congratulated on the sideline. He's on the field, but he may come off here in a second. Go ahead and finish your thought on the defense for the Giants
here
today.
You know, you look back to week one against Dallas, then they came back week two against the Green Bay Packers, started the year out 0-2, and had given up a lot of yards. I mean, I think they were ranked like second to last defensively in terms of yards given up, and they just hung in there, and that's a credit to these players, but it's also a credit to Steve Spagnuolo and the job that he did of really selling his system and having these guys believe in what it was that they were doing. And you know, you talk to these players, and the reason that they hung in there with him was because, you know, he creates an environment that these players want to play for him, and they don't want to disappoint him, and they sure have not done that. I mean, they have played well since then. They played well all season long. They've had a great game here today.
For those Giants fans who were able to get tickets in this stadium, there's some controversy around that, are making noise now, and the Giant offense is on the field down in the area where McQuarters made what looks to be an interception, which would seal this day and in essence end it. It's a 10-point game as it is, and we're under a booth review waiting for the call from Walt Anderson. But you know this, we know Tom Coughlin well enough to know that the in the first sentence or at the most second sentence he will talk about not turning the ball over, talk about Eli, the job his defense did. Here's the call.
After reviewing the play, it is an interception. The defender has both feet inbounds and control of the football. It'll be New York's ball, first down on the 18-yard line.
This is a head coach, Troy, that talks about turnovers more than any other that we talk to. And you think about Eli. He turned the ball over 27 times this season, 20 interceptions. He fumbled 7 times, losing at 7. And he has really guarded the football today, made smart decisions, and they have not given it up.
Yeah, and sometimes when you're so protective and not wanting to make a mistake, then you play so conservatively that you don't give your team a chance to be successful. I thought Eli did a great job of balancing, not throwing the ball in danger, but not letting it restrict him from giving his team and his players around him an opportunity to have some success.
Buccaneers have only one timeout left. Ahmad Bradshaw, one of the stars today for the Giants, gets a couple of extra hits at the end. With a minute 48 remaining, the Buccaneers take their final timeout. By the way, the turnover ratio during the regular season, Tampa Bay was plus 15, number one in the NFC. The Giants were minus 9, the bottom
Tampa
of the league.
30-second timeout.
The Giants today are plus 3. That turnover ratio for the Giants, 26th in the NFL, and the worst among playoff teams at minus 9 during the regular season.
Had that shot of Eli just a moment ago. Doesn't it look like he's maybe lost a little weight? You know, like he was able to shed some pounds that may have been hanging around his neck for the last couple of years. And, you know, that's a great feeling for any quarterback to go out and when you win that first playoff game, particularly when there has been as much pressure as there has been on him. We talked about how long it took his brother Peyton Manning, you know, one of the best, if not the best quarterback in the National Football League, and this will be a great ride home for Eli, knowing that he just got his first one under his belt as well.
It'll be back-to-back big game performances by Eli Manning as Bradshaw carries it for one. Next week, we will be there in Dallas for the NFC's highest scoring team, the Dallas Cowboys, at just under 28.5 points per game, best in the conference. An NFL record 12 Pro Bowlers now that Roy Williams has been added, place of the late Sean Taylor. And it's been 11 years since their last playoff win, the wild card round against Minnesota in 96.
Yeah, and the Giants, you know, they played Dallas well in Dallas. A year ago, they were able to go into Dallas and beat Dallas. This past year, they opened up the season and were very successful offensively. You know, it's going to be a challenge for them to get up again emotionally to go out and put together the kind of game that they hope to be able to play. But yet they should. They match up pretty well against that Dallas team. I know Dallas is watching this game knowing that they were going to take whoever the winner was. You know, they've had the week off, and that'll certainly benefit them. But it should be a great game. Two teams that know each other awfully well.
You can see Eli Manning saying we're going to take a timeout when there's 1 second left on the play clock. It's fourth down. Barrett Rood made that last stop of Bradshaw. And Eli Manning last week against the Patriots, 22 of 32, 251 yards, a 118.6 quarterback rating, 4 touchdowns, but he did throw an interception and fumble once. Today did not turn the ball over. And that's why with 16 seconds left, he and the Giants are going to fly out of here awfully happy. Today's game being produced by Richie Zients, directed by Artie Kempner. A thanks to Steve Horn, editorial consultant here in the booth. The technical producer is Joe Stevens. Technical director is Colby Bourgeois. The audio mixer, Fred Aldis. The associate directors are Greg Scopitone and Derek Manning. Broadcast associates are Zach Fields and Rich Gross. Halftime show produced by Scott Ackerson, directed by Bob Levy. technical supervisor for the studios, Jack Simmons, the senior producer of Fox Sports, Bill Brown, and the executive producers of Fox Sports are Ed Gorin and David Hill. Nobody is wading deep for the Bucs, who are down by 10 with 16 seconds to play. Fiegels, a wily veteran, just gets it one step and boom, and hits one of his better punts of the day. And now 7 seconds are left. The Giants defense will have a chance to be on the field when this thing ends. And you have to congratulate the regular season work of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. A great job by John Gruden infusing a lot of young talent. Jeff Garcia had the bad back, missed 2 games in early December, played only 6 quarters the last 5 games, worried that he might be too rested, didn't look too sharp, and the offense just could not get any big plays today when it counted.
Yeah, and I think that, and I agree with all that, Joe. I mean, they've had a good year. All these teams that make it into the playoffs had to have had good seasons in order to get in. But, you know, I know it leaves a bad taste in the mouth of this Tampa Bay Buccaneer team. 2 years ago, they have the home field wild card game against the Washington Redskins. They failed to win that game, and now they host the Giants in a wild card game and fail to win this game as well. Those are hard losses to overcome.
Garcia down the field and nearly picked off by Butler. This game is over. And congratulations to the New York Giants. Eli Manning, the face man for this franchise. A date with the Dallas Cowboys awaits next Sunday at 4 o'clock Eastern. We'll come back and wrap up our day. Plenty more to come today on the NFL on Fox. 24-14, Giants win it. Off to Dallas they go next Sunday. Back after this. 24-14 is the final, and a big day for Eli Manning. He should be smiling down there on the field with the way he played. Did not turn the ball over. Our UPS leaderboard. UPS, what can Brown do for you? Not a spectacular day yardage wise, but 2 touchdowns, no turnovers. 20 of 27 was Eli Manning. Ernest Graham for the Buccaneers rushed for 63 yards. And Lonnie Toomer, a big day receiving for the Giants. 7 catches, 74 yards, and a touchdown. So until next Sunday, when the Giants will be in Dallas, we say so long. The postgame show coming up after the break as the Giants move on. Coughlin, a postseason win for New York. We focus. Let's go get it.
And we welcome you to the AT&T postgame show. Kurt Menefee along with Terry, Howie, and Jimmy following the Giants' 24-14 victory in the wild card matchup with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And as you heard Joe Buck said, it's the first postseason win for the Giants since 2000, 7 long seasons. And guys, you know, we started this pregame show by talking about Eli Manning and whether or not he could perform. It looked like he did today against the Bucs.
I'll tell you, hostile crowd, 80,000 Buccaneer fans greeting Jeff Garcia. There's Eli Manning, a lot of discussion about him and his growth as a quarterback. We see Ernest Graham go in for Tampa Bay, 1 yard touchdown, 7-0 Buccaneers over the Giants. And then Eli Manning back looking, a little, it's kind of a strange pass. I don't know what that was. Howie likes to call it a check down. It's Brandon Jacobs. We're tied up at 7-all. Manning looking right, pulls it back. That is a check down. Finds Steve Smith, 21-yard completion, still tied up at 7-all. Second quarter now. There you hand off. 8 yards later, touchdown, Giants on the road. And remember, coming into this game, 7-1, their record on the road, 14-7, Giants over Tampa Bay. Then Michael Spurlock in the second half, fumbles the ball, Corey Webster recovered for the Giants. That would lead to a Lawrence Tynes 25-yard field goal, 17-7, Giants on the road, inspired football on top of Tampa Bay. Jeff Garcia, not a good day. Poor decision, poorly thrown ball, intercepted in the end zone by Corey Webster. Score still 17, Giants, Tampa Bay, 7. And then Eli Manning setting up, pump, pull the guy over, go back to the outside. Amani Toomer there on the reception. And it's 24-14, the New York Giants over the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
And look at the numbers for Eli, 20 of 27. The yard is not great, but more importantly, 2 touchdown passes, 0 interception, as Eli gets his first ever victory in 3 tries as a starting quarterback in the postseason, and afterwards talked about the victory with our Pam Oliver.
All right, thanks a lot, Kurt. Eli, one monkey off your back. I mean, what is it like to finally have yourself a playoff win and one for this team that hasn't had one in a long time?
Well, it's a great feeling. The last three, you know, third year in a row making it to the playoffs, but not getting past the first round. So it was a great game. Offensive guys, we stepped up. We had a great drive at the fourth quarter to go down there and get points, 92 yards. So defense played great. This is a great win.
Kudos to Kevin Gilbride on this. I mean, his offensive game plan. I mean, you guys, you know, weren't afraid of the fact that they were obviously the number one pass defense in the NFL.
No, and they are a good defense, but we did a good job protecting. Short passing game, receivers getting open. A few throws we had to hold a little bit. We had some more opportunities, so we missed some. But guys stepped up, made big plays in situations to get that win.
And finally, what do the Giants have going for them as they head to Dallas this time around?
Well, we've been there before. We know what it's like, and they're a tough team. As we play them twice every year, but I think we're going to be ready, and we're fired up to be going to Dallas.
Congratulations to you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Back to you, Kirk.
Okay, Pam, and we will talk about next week's matchup between the Giants and the Cowboys, plus all the divisional round matchups in just a bit. But let's get back to this game, Jimmy, and the performance by Eli Manning. And as we said in the pregame show, this was his chance to make or break maybe, well, not his legacy, but what his career has been so far in New York, and it really was a continuation of what he did against New England.
Yeah, and, you know, winning the first playoff game, and then on top of that, the last 2 weeks, 6 touchdowns, only 1 interception, played great today. If you talk to Tom Coughlin about Eli Manning, he would say he played fantastic because they had no turnovers. You look at the stats of the game as far as Tampa and New York, pretty well, you know, similar, you know, through the total offense, third down percentage, on and on, but it was different in two phases. Turnovers, 3 turnovers for Tampa, 0 for New York, and obviously the score.
You know, it's interesting, the way Eli's year started. Tiki Barber takes a barb at Eli and his leadership and it almost being comical, him getting up in front of the room, and Eli responding verbally to that, which I think the New York Giants wanted to see, the team wanted to see, the organization wanted to see. And then last week versus the New England Patriots, it was almost as if he just blossomed before your eyes last week versus the Patriots. The one interception and a poor decision at the end of the game, okay, the rest of it was great. Today, took what was there, didn't force the issue. Once again, responding on the field, not verbally, to what Rondé Barber had said prior to this game. I think Eli kind of has evolved over the last couple of weeks, as this Giants football team has.
Well, yeah, the key for any quarterback or any football team, we're making all this about Eli Manning. Put a team around him. Put a team around him. Put receivers around him. You get the running game around him. Protect him. And then you'll see an average quarterback become good, a good one become very great, and a great one become legendary. But the key for me is the fact, and why we didn't all just jump on it, was the fact that they are winning on the road. And Eli Manning, while I agree with you that that maybe his statement game was New England, I agree with Coughlin in starting his starter. I'm more impressed with how well, he has played against the Cowboys, although he's lost both of those games. He has played extremely well, and especially down at Dallas Stadium.
Well, let me ask you this. I mean, we made this about Eli Manning, but as you said, it's not just about
Eli.
If you think a lot of pressure's off Eli Manning, what about Tom Coughlin? Here's a guy that everybody thought a month ago was maybe close to getting fired. He's won 10 regular season games and now gotten him into the second round of the playoffs.
1 year left on his contract. 1 year left on John Gruden's contract.
Has he taken care of all the doubters?
I got to think Tom Coughlin's going to get a good extension.
You look at his career there at New York, he's had a very successful career and is going to get better. So, yes, you know, Tom Coughlin's done a fine job there.
Yeah, and so is Gruden. Gruden's got a young football team down there in Tampa Bay. Just needs to get him a quarterback because Jeff is going to be 38 years old next year.
Well, it looks like the Giants have their quarterback for quite a while. The way Eli Manning has played the last couple of weeks, we mentioned the New England game, and of course today against Tampa Bay, he just keeps on doing it and looks like, as you said, TB, he's kind of turned the corner.
Well, he didn't force it. Howie said he didn't force the issue, and that's the really key. A little check down there, Ernest Graham, you see a little drop off, Manning.
Not mechanical there.
That's okay, Howie. You're not going to be able to set your feet on every pass.
That's
down
right.
The feet, Toomer ends. A lot of end routes, a lot of man coverage up early, and he saw that. There he goes to the outside, Tremonti Toomer for the touchdown. When he saw the man, he had the crossing routes, and when he didn't, when they finally went to zone, then he started picking him apart. Garcia, on the other hand, incomplete pass. And this is in the end zone. Poorly thrown ball. Shouldn't have thrown it. I mean, just an underthrow. Intercepted by Webster. Garcia back. Incomplete pass. Down the middle. Where's the receiver? I have no idea. Garcia nearly intercepted. A bad read. Garcia. Pump.
throwing off his back foot, an interception that closes out this football game. The thing that Tampa Bay had not done all year was the fact that they had not turned the football over, and it was the very thing in playoff game that you cannot do. They did it today, therefore they lose the game.
Well, Howie, I want to talk about Jeff Garcia, because he's always been a guy who's been a little jitterbuggy back there, but today it was in a negative way.
40 times, 24 hurries, 12 hits. Jeff Garcia never had the opportunity to set his feet or extend the playing field.
All right, up next, we will take you back to Tampa and hear from Michael Strahan as the Giants celebrate moving on in the playoffs. And we'll look ahead to the NFC's final foursome. Also, we'll preview the BCS Championship Showdown tomorrow night right here on Fox. Plus, Jay Glazer will have all the latest coaching news. Well, the Giants move on thanks to Brandon Jacobs with two touchdowns in the game. The G-men win it 24-14 to advance to the divisional round. You're watching the AT&T Postgame Show on Fox.
They're playing for here in New Orleans tomorrow night, the All-State BCS National Championship Trophy, and who will it be, Ohio State or LSU? The Tigers on offense, like Ohio State, a very balanced team and not afraid to run two quarterbacks at you if they have to.
It'll start with Matt Flynn. He's been their starter for much of the year, even though he's been injured at times. Did not play in the SEC Championship game due to a shoulder injury, so Ryan Perilou filled in and was the game MVP. So they have two quarterbacks who can give problems to the Ohio State defense. But the guy they want to hand the ball to is Jacob Hester, their starting tailback. Over 1,000 yards on the ground. He also catches passes out of the backfield. And how about this? He also covers kicks on the kickoff team. He gives them a lot of toughness.
On defense, however, it's a tall order for the Tigers. It's a number one ranked defense in all of college football. The Ohio State Buckeyes, led by their two All-Americans, James Laurinaitis and Vernon Golston.
Well, James Laurinaitis won the Bucs Award, emblematic of the best linebacker in the country, and he deserved it. Over 100 tackles on the field, and he also diagnoses plays so well and gets Ohio State in the right defenses. And Vernon Golston is a terror off the edge. 14 sacks on the season. He's one of the best rush guys in the country. He's going to be trying to get after either quarterback for LSU.
So which team will host the national championship trophy when all is said and done here tomorrow night? Ohio State or LSU? Our coverage begins at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific. Kurt, back to you.
Thank you, Tom. And, you know, Jimmy Johnson will be on the pregame show, so we won't get your opinion on that game just yet. We'll save it for tomorrow night. Why don't I start with you, Howie? Who will win this game?
You know, I think this is an interesting game for Ohio State. They've had to eat crow for an entire offseason, one entire year, listening to everyone about the speed of their conference, the SEC. They can't compete with them. This Louisiana State University football team, particularly on offense, is a more traditional group with Flynn at quarterback. They can spread you out and go spread option with Perilou at quarterback. Jacob Hester, Terry's third cousin, he's related to two-thirds of the state, is a phenomenal football player.
You got a problem with
I
that?
I love him. I think Ohio State matches up much better with this group than they did with Florida last year. I'm going to take Ohio State because you're going to take LSU in a big upset.
Well, I'm a Louisiana boy.
I know you
I'm
have
from
to.
Shreveport.
Yeah.
The only thing that concerns me about picking LSU is that in watching LSU play this year, quarterback Matt Flynn has made big mistakes in close football games, and that concerns me. Perilou coming in gives them a new dimension, a little more speed on the outside, a guy that's a little more athletic. But Flynn has made poor decisions, especially go back to the Kentucky game, in which he made guys were open and he missed them wide open. So just from that point, I'm a little nervous about it, but I'm going to go with LSU. They're playing in their own backyard at New Orleans, and they're from Baton Rouge.
They will have to make good decisions because Ohio State's very good on run defense. Outstanding defensive team. Right.
Les Miles will double down, as we found out this year. He will make controversial decisions throughout the course of the football
and
game.
Make a couple of gambles throughout the game and go for some plays you wouldn't expect. But as you said, Ohio State, the number one defense in the nation coming into this championship game.
Double down. Double down.
Speaking of great defenses, well, the Giants, they look like one today, led by their 14-year veteran Michael Strahan. He led the team in tackles, got their only sack in the victory over the Buccaneers that moved them on to the second round. And afterwards, Strahan had a chance to talk with our Pam Oliver about the victory.
All right, thanks a lot, Kirk. Michael, how much did the defensive game plan play out as designed today against Jeff Garcia?
I mean, played out pretty well. We wanted to pressure him, make him feel that, you know, with the presence, that he wasn't just going to drop back and have a lot of time to throw the ball. And I felt like we hit him a lot, stopped the run decently, not as well as we need to. But I think we did the things that we need to according to our game plan to win.
It's been a minute since you guys have won a playoff game. I mean, what's it like to just finally get that monkey off your back? And it really seems things are going well for you guys at just the right time.
Well, it feels like we're coming together at the right time, offensively, defensively, special teams is playing well. Now, that's a good thing, because this is when you really need that. And, you know, I think as a team, we feel pretty confident that we can beat anybody right now. As long as we stay healthy, everybody continues to play for each other and one another, we'll be safe.
Does that include Dallas?
That includes Dallas. Includes everybody. I believe that we can beat everybody. If we didn't believe that, we wouldn't be here.
Thanks, Michael.
Thank you.
Back to you, Kirk.
All right, Pam and Howie, Michael believes they can beat anybody, including Dallas. I tell you what, if they get pressure like they did today, there's no reason not to think that.
The Giants in the last 2 weeks can beat anyone, and I think for them, their coverage starts with their front four. Steve Spagnuolo came over from the Philadelphia Eagles running Jim Johnson's scheme, a different scheme from what Jim Johnson does. He's adapted their scheme to fit the personnel they have. Michael Strahan with the one sack here today. 24 hurries, 12 hits, one sack today. Tuck, Umanura, Strahan. This is where their coverage comes from. Ross has been good at corner, but their coverage, make no mistake about it, starts up front with their defensive front.
And Howie, he's exactly right. They can beat anybody if they don't turn the football over. Had zero turnovers in the game today. If you don't turn the ball over, you're going to be in every single game right to the very end.
I said that walking out of the hotel today.
You
4:45.
Thought it.
I thought
you,
it.
You thought it, but I said it.
All right, so now the Giants will take on Dallas in one NFC matchup. The other one is Seattle and Green Bay. We're down to the final four in the NFC. What should we expect? Well, check it out. It wasn't pretty, but Seattle got the W yesterday and the ticket to round two. Hasselbeck likes calling for the ball when facing the Packers in the postseason.
Heads! Seattle has won the toss.
We want the ball, we're going to score.
I would just say it right now. We want the ball and we're going to score.
NFC sack leader Patrick Kearney and company will be hunting for four. Who leads the best offense in the conference? The rested Pack are steadfast at home. Check this out. They've won 9 of the last 10 games at Lambeau. And Green Bay is 2-0 in the playoffs after a bye.
1, 2, 3, 4!
With a win over the Bucs today, the Giants now face a familiar foe in the Cowboys. After sweeping the regular season for the first time since 2003, Dallas goes for the three-peat against their division rival. Of course, the big question in Big D is whether the ankle of T.O. is ready to go. You'll remember he suffered the sprain back on December 22nd in Carolina. Team officials are optimistic that Owens will be back in the starting lineup after a week of intensive rehab sessions. As for the Giants, they look to keep momentum going all the way into Texas Stadium, a place where they've had some success, going 4-4 in the last 8 games. And check this out. This will be the first ever postseason meeting between these two historic teams. And Howie, you take a look at it, and coverage begins on Saturday with the Seattle-Green Bay matchup, the Subway Fresh Buzz divisional playoff matchups, right here on Fox, starts at 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific. Then on Sunday, the G-Men will head over to Big D to face Tony Romo and the Cowboys, beginning at 4 o'clock Eastern, 1 Pacific, right here on Fox. And once again, Howie, you take a look at it, New York and Dallas, and New York has reason to feel good the way they played the 2 regular season games against Dallas. Even though they were losses, they were in them.
Yeah, they were in them, and I think you look at the, for lack of a better way of putting it, the litmus test games for the New York Giants this year, the 2 Dallas games, you look at the Green Bay game, you look at the Jacksonville game, they lost to Washington, and then they lost to New England at the end of the year last week and played well. Since the 1970 merger, 53 times one team has played another 3 times in that season. 11 of those times the team has swept. We played in our Super Bowl year, Seattle, 3 times. We lost them the first 2 times and crushed them in the playoffs. The Giants got hot here at the right time, particularly at the quarterback position. And you could walk out the door in the morning of a broadcast and say, turnovers and special teams. They impacted the game today without question across the board.
Well, Jimmy, you take a look at it, and I go way back to the beginning of the season, and you were talking about the Seattle Seahawks making the run maybe all the way through the NFC. Well, they've got a chance now going into Green Bay.
Well, in fact, that was my pick, Seattle against New England in the Super Bowl, but I think Seattle will have a very difficult time. as Terry knows, I'm not really a stat guy, but one,
you're not a guy to pat yourself in the back either.
One stat is the turnovers, and the other stat is, you know, a team that's got a bye playing at home in the playoffs going to win over 80% of the time. It'll be
they didn't today in Tampa.
No, they didn't have a bye. Bye. Bye.
Sorry,
no, right. In the future, I'll just interpret it.
But so Green Bay playing at home, youngest team in the league. Playing with a veteran quarterback, they'll be very difficult to beat there in Lambeau. But Seattle, the way they're playing defense, they could be a surprise.
Jimmy, we've seen it all year long. Teams that we think will win at home lose at home, like today in Tampa Bay. Green Bay, Holmgren, since even including in playoffs, has gone back to Green Bay three times.
They got a street named after.
As the coach at Seattle, and lost all three games. So, you know, it's a great matchup. Weather, we'll see how it is.
Especially since Green Bay's got a bye.
Bye, which means 80% of the time.
I got you now.
Speaking of bye, we'll say bye to you guys right now and bring in our NFL insider, Jay Glazer. And Jay, Vince Young and that quad injury, he's expected to start today, but will he start for sure, and how long might he play?
Yes, he will start for sure. Two of his offensive linemen, they're deactivated. What's going to happen with Vince Young? As long as he can show that he can get away from trouble, Jeff Fisher will keep him in. If he thinks he struggles at all, not performance-wise, just injury-wise, he has a short leash on.
Well, let's talk about the coaching carousel in the NFL. And there were reports that Cowboys assistant coach Tony Sparano has been offered the head coaching job in Miami. Is that true?
No truth to that whatsoever. What's happened is he had a great interview with the team, and the team actually started talking contract with him, is what he told some of his friends, his assistants around the NFL. I don't know if he thought that meant they're giving him the job. Now, that's not to say that he is the front runner, because he's certainly the front runner, but tomorrow they're going to interview Leslie Frazier, the defensive coordinator for the Minnesota Vikings. On Tuesday, Rex Ryan, defensive coordinator for the Baltimore Ravens. I tell you what, if there's a dark horse in this, it probably will be Rex Ryan. Also, guys like Greg Williams, he's on their list also.
Now, let me ask you this, a two-part question. First of all, do you think that Tony Sparano actually ends up getting the job in Miami? And if so, where does that leave Silvio and Phil Leotardo?
Yeah, and Paulie Walnuts.
Exactly.
I don't know what's going to happen with him. No, I do think in the end he gets the job. Again, the dark horse here is probably a guy like Rex Ryan, who has the same philosophy as Bill Parcells and Jeff Ireland.
All right, let's move on to Baltimore. And they're looking to replace Brian Billick. Where are the Ravens looking?
You know, I tell you what, the Ravens are looking everywhere you could possibly imagine. They're interviewing Rex Ryan today. They have about 30 guys on their list of who they want to interview. The most interesting candidate is probably Marty Ball, Marty Schottenheimer. He's talked to Ozzie Newsome. I think they're going to interview him not in the first round of interviews. Instead, after the second wave, Marty said he wants to go toward the end of the interview process. But Mike Solari, the former offensive coordinator of the Kansas City Chiefs, and Cam Cameron have both said to them, to Marty, we'll join your staff if you get that gig.
Hey, Brian Billick is the guy who lost the job there. Is there any interest in him around the league?
You know, he talked to Mike Nolan about his offensive coordinator job. Don't know if that's going to be a fit. Remember, Nolan worked for him. But also, Mike Nolan will interview Mike March tomorrow for his offensive coordinator job.
All right, finally, let's talk about Atlanta. Who are they interviewing this week?
You know, the Atlanta Falcons, they're going all over the place also. I think they're looking at the Tennessee game today. If Jim Schwartz loses, they'll bring him in. They also have Rex Ryan on their list. Guys like Sparano, Jason Garrett, they've already interviewed as well.
All right, thanks a lot for the insight, as always.
Thank you, buddy.
We'll catch you on cable. All right. Hey, you brought up a good point. Ozzie Newsome actually played for Marty Schottenheimer
in Cleveland.
So there is a connection there. Yeah. We'll find out whether or not that proves true and hear from John Gruden when we come back with the AT&T postgame show.